Oh, there it goes. I was wondering if they might have reset the stream key again without letting me know or something. But no, looks like we are indeed live. Cool. And then there's going to be an echo because I didn't mute that. But now we're good. Cool. So I can fix this. There we go. Wonderful. That was strange. So what are we doing for the giveaway keyword? I'll get that going. And we'll get MoCloud on the call. Okay. Let's get good old MoCog on over here. Oh, that's not the right room. Calling the wrong people. All right, now let's try that again.
Ghost
There we
Mother. Hi.
How's it going, buddy?
I am doing all right. And oh, hi. That's interesting. Okay. I just now saw the camera waving a bobber over there.
Yep. Was that
I
calling the
feel
wrong people?
stretched.
You what?
I feel stretched and
Yeah, I
jealous.
gotta fix your camera again. It seems like that is a regular ritual at this point. All right, so what do we got going on here?
House mirror,
Let's get a video.
the fun house mirror.
And I think
But
usually closing that helps, maybe? No, that doesn't seem to have helped. Let's try this one more time. All right, other Skype video. Hey, there we go. No. Oh, we got meowing cats. And I finally have this fixed. So let's put that on over there. We'll not make you so tiny, perhaps. And then we can. Hey! What do you
Alive.
know? That looks much better. And kaboom! There we go. Wonderful. So we're indeed live. We got a lot of fun stuff to be doing today.
Hi, mon capitaine. So many beautiful things to do, so much to talk about. It is so magnifique. I don't know
but
where that
bef
came from. I
that
apologize.
that was nice and random. before we get into fun stuff, what how's your week been? How you doing over there, Mocha? A face?
I'm
Some,
okay.
you're hanging in there, huh?
yeah, it's one of those. It's a busy week. I've been trying to catch up with General Stet stuff to make sure that we can keep getting the stuff going live on YouTube.
Yeah.
I'm still working on getting the parallel system set up to record while we're doing those, and that's in process
Cool.
because that system is linked to a stream machine I'm trying to get set up so that I can do other games in addition to Hex. But that is a complicated setup that takes a lot of time when I don't have a huge
When
amount of time
time is
every
a
week.
limited commodity,
Yes.
yeah.
So trying to get that set up. But when that's set up, I can dual record our stream so that we don't have to have that issue with the burden hitting your machine. So that way we keep everything nice and copacetic there.
Yeah.
But then also, trying to take care of adulty things.
Yep.
Kind of sucks being adult sometimes.
Yep. I wholeheartedly agree with that part. It'd be
and you
nice.
know, it's one of those things where, you know, and plus we have like really cool stuff happening in the community. In fact,
Yeah.
we I think we've totally got like our first serious MTG convert. Like, not just, you
Oh,
know, I know we're pulling
yeah. I
in
saw something about
I know we're pulling fans from all sorts of other games,
For
or
like
they're just
a
like, hey, what's
tournament.
this really cool new thing
Yeah.
going on? But now we have a new streamer up who is actually streaming right now, who is definitely pulling some good stuff.
I'm gonna fix my headphones here real quick because the cord is all tangled, but I can still talk because I muted my thing, so I'm still totally fine. But I actually can't hear you because I unplugged my headphones, so I'm talking
But
to
you can't hear
myself.
me, that means I
And
can
let me
curse
fix
all I
this.
want right
There we
now, but the
go. That's
stream
much better.
can hear me, I think. Or I'm muted and the stream can't
I'm
hear
back.
me, one of the
Well,
two.
no, they could all hear you, but I couldn't. But now my cord is no longer in a knot and no longer bothering me because that was annoying. But now it's all twisted. I hate that. But yeah, so we
But
got.
yeah, other than adulty type stuff, I've actually been having a ton of fun in Hex. We
Nice.
did our
Nice.
also did the first run through of the Adventures of Golden Gear.
Nice. What is the Adventures of Golden Gear?
For those who have done Dino Island before, Golden Gear is one of he's one of the early encounters, and he's a very infuriating encounter because he's full of removal. He's a jank bot deck. Sometimes it feels as though you're getting really good ground with him, and he's just he's beastly in the Dino Island concept. Okay. But he's also a deranged mad dwarf who loves to.
I think I've heard that voice once or twice.
And so, yes, and Hyundai's got his things. Very awesome. I want a picture of that Hyundai, by the way. Link it. I think you can link it in chat. If not, link it to me via message, because I will tweet that son of a gun out in a heartbeat. Yeah. Everyone should have their stuff from our General Stint giveaway. It finally looks like it finally all made it to the mail system. Heading out to Ireland and Germany for those guys. And I learned quite a bit about international shipping doing that. It didn't take a full arm and a leg.
Why don't we get started on the show notes before we go off on too many tangents?
But I love Jarajist.
Yeah.
Okay, fine. Show notes. Okay, so are some of the big stuff we've got going today, other than me totally wasting everyone's time, I love wasting everyone's time. Function. It's like my favorite thing to do.
The best pastime.
Aside from like play Hex and maybe like watch videos of like people playing Hex.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so like maybe my third or fourth favorite thing to do in the world. Any case. We've got some fun stuff from the forums we want to talk about today. Something that we cooked up last week that is coming to fruition. We've got a general FAQ for what's coming up the first week of March. We've got a new external article, a game industry article that I think is really good to highlight on our community stuff.
I think I saw that one.
And then not a huge amount of people heard about it. It was a really small thing that came across, and I was like lucky to find it on Twitter.
Mm-hmm.
And then we got some official stuff, something we didn't cover last week that I think we should probably show off a little bit. And I realized that the link to that is incorrect. I'll have to get you a correct link for the thing that we missed last week.
Mm-hmm.
But then we've got a new article up by Jacob Martin, who was actually one of the primary design forces for Adventure Zone 1.
Mm-hmm.
And then we got some snazzy playmat stuff going on. And we've got some stuff to dive in on our weekly topic side, maybe some of our favorite PvE decks, a little conversation about Set 4, which I think is a really good point that we'll want to run on.
Mm-hmm.
You know, maybe toss a little bit of chat checkup, whether or not we have what we have written down on the on the notes is debatable, because I think we might have done that last week. But then also, you know, there's different cards of the week, maybe a few top buys and sells, total, ton of giveaways, that kind of stuff.
Yeah, so figuring out giveaways. Starting off, we will be doing our raffle for our Avatar of Cowardice. That's going to be two raffles. I think there's 41 people entered.
Sweet.
And by the time we started, we had 41 people, and that's going to be the cutoff. Although if people want to still submit and just take part in the thread, they're welcome to do that. But for the ease of doing today's show, it is cut off to the 41 people who've already submitted an Avatar of Cowardice to us. So we have that, and those are going to be two drawings for three packs each. We have our two draft codes that we're giving away. We have the Convocation stack. We have the Crack-A-Pack. And then whatever else we throw in there, which might be a thing or two as we get going. So, but yeah, so we got all that. We want to start off with the very first piece of news here, the Invitational FAQ that you have on the show notes.
Yes, so one of the first things we've got going on. So for those who are considering attending, the Invitational, we have a wonderful thread that has been started up that's got some good information on there. So, you know, different things like where it's going to be at, you know, that there's no entry, you know, where the profiles for each of the contestants are, you know, what are people going for at each level, you know, some wonderful stuff like some input by a lot of folks, and then, you know, some input from Fenteo on there as well. I think they might have even put the hotel info in there at some point, though they may have actually pulled that down.
Yeah, I looked at the very first, like, I looked at that thread when it initially came out, but it only had a few responses, so I haven't really seen as it's continued to develop. I would imagine there's some more stuff that has popped up on there that is relevant and pertinent and for people going, and perhaps interesting for the people that aren't. But it sounds like a fun time, and it would have been nice to go. But
all right, I think mm-hmm. I might be able to pull off getting there.
Oh, you're thinking about going?
Yeah.
Nice. Well, there's
a few things that need to settle out, but okay. I'm 90% sure, you know, barring natural disaster,
nice.
I'll be able to make it.
That sounds like a good time. Well, if you do make it, I think I know a certain somebody who would like to acquire a playmat. So,
Just
throwing that out there.
Understood. That can actually. So here's my plan. If I can make it out there, mm-hmm. there's definitely going to be. I want to try to be sure to get like posters for, of course, myself. Try mm-hmm. to get something for the channel. Yeah. Try to get something for the general's tent. Try to get something for those. It really depends on what the limitations are for what we'll be able to do for others. Because mm-hmm. I love doing a poster giveaway, and I'd like to save up for either the end of the year or like some
milestone.
Some particular milestone to have like one of those mm-hmm. Playmat as well, that kind of stuff. I love being able to give that physical stuff away because it's so hard and very rare for folks to be able to do.
Lou Knight's saying he's going to get into those.
So we're going to try to do and take care of that. We're probably going to drive on there.
Nice.
And because it's 'cause you've done that. You've done a very similar drive to that before. It would be my first time driving out that way.
Mm-hmm.
And it looks, 'cause it's about a 21-hour drive.
Yep. That sounds make it over there. About right from where you're at.
And, so one of the things where I'm hoping to be able to do along the way is, to see stars. Because you know what? When you live in a city, you don't see stars all that often.
Yep, that's very much true.
To try to do that, and it'll be one of my first times driving through mountains.
Okay.
I've driven around high hills.
Yeah.
High hills are not mountains.
No, they definitely are not.
We're cutting, I know, at least along the southern end of the Rockies to try to get over there, and you have to go through the mountains. Mountainous part of California to get down into Santa Ana. So that's going to be an experience, and everyone pray I don't die. Because I'm from Texas. We have low rolling hills and mostly flat land. It's a different thing. But all of that together, I think it's going to be a really fun excursion.
Yeah.
That we can get out there.
You have other stuff that you want to do while you're in California, or is that the main thing you're going for?
The main thing is going to be Hex. Cool. Maybe see, depending on when we get in there, maybe see if they actually will allow people in around Wednesday at the Cryptozoic offices. We'll see. Everything's always up in the air.
See, that's the tricky part, right? So if it has 300 people attendance, actually I realized we never got the raffle going, so I'm going to get that going right now. General's tent to enter our raffle. If it has 300 people attendance, there's like no way that, or at least not that I could picture, that game night could facilitate 100 people going there. So like, or not,
they have
not
to set there's up tents
300
the
people
office.
Like that. And then even then, like, so say they even did what you were saying, and they made it like the capacity thing not be the problem. It still wouldn't mm-hmm. be the experience people want, because people would want to like see the office and talk to the people. And when there's 300 people there, all in a very short time span, you might get to talk to somebody for 1 minute, and that's not really worth the trip at that point, right? So, that's definitely a tricky part I obviously can't speak to, because that's for them to figure out, I suppose. But
So, I mean, I know there's a lot of things up in the air. I mean, mm-hmm. the big event's going to be there for the weekend.
Yeah.
I know we're having a lot of Five Shards crew and folks there, and hopefully we'll see how that turns out. I know I'm bringing buttons. I know for a fact I'm bringing buttons.
Nice.
The question is which buttons will I be bringing?
Yeah. Oh, okay.
I know Five Shards is planning some really fun stuff. For everyone who's also able to make it as well.
Very neat.
So that's the FAQ. The FAQ, it's in the link. You can find it up there on the forums as well. But it's definitely, if you can do it, That'll be sweet.
Yeah, no, that sounds like a good time. Definitely check out, what was I going to say? Oh, the giveaway is now live, so you can do !! General Stent, and that's going. We already have like 4 or 5 people entered in there. And yeah, so FAQ, check that out. Next up is, why don't we do our avatars like as the last piece of all of the news? Because that one's kind of fun. And we can knock out these other ones pretty quickly, hopefully.
I mean, the next one we've got is this one is an industry-based article. So the important part about this one is that it's actually an interview with Corey.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
About a lot of the different things that kind of from an industry perspective they're wanting to know. A good chunk of it focuses on like the MMO TCG side of it.
It's still very light. It's kind of just, you know, it is industry side, but not like really talking about anything in particular, but it's still interesting to see, and it's a nice little read, especially for, like, it seems like a lot of stuff that Hex puts out, it's mostly targeted towards people who aren't familiar with the game, and trying to introduce it out to people, because that's where they are in this stage of development, and yeah, I thought it was still interesting.
Yeah, I'd say it's a very good primer.
Mm-hmm.
I would say it's kind of like your next level introduction type of material.
Yeah.
Someone goes, like, oh, what is Hextole about? Here's it in the creator's own words. Mm-hmm. Have a good go.
But there's some interesting thoughts from Corey, and kind of their outlook is, you know, they're mostly focused on making the best game they can make and not as worried about, like, what other people are doing kind of thing is at least part of the vibe I got from it, you know?
Oh, yeah. There was actually I would say a little bit of a baity question in there that was very interesting. So there was a, you know, to the article's credit, you know, it calls out like one of the gorillas in the room. It's just like, you know, when you have competition like Hearthstone, you know, was Hearthstone kind of like a proof of concept or as an obstacle? You know, what was that goal on there? Corey's answer to that was very good. And, let's see if I can pull something really quick here, because he has a really good quote on there. So his summation of that was really good. It's like, it doesn't have to be a competition. They provide a specific experience, and we provide a different one, even though we're both card games on the surface.
Yeah, I think that's a good way of putting it. Like, the Venn diagram that of the two games, it definitely, like, while, yes, they have some overlap, there is a lot of area they don't. Like, it's... They are for very different players. Like, there's no doubt about that, I would say. And
yeah.
And that's just important to, like, be aware of. I think somebody who isn't familiar with both games or doesn't, like, look at games in maybe, like, a critical analysis perspective, that's not going to be as obvious. They're like, oh, you're just playing cards. And yeah, that's true. Like, there's more to it, and there's things that distinguish each game unto themselves. And so, yeah, but either way, the article's still a nice little read, and hopefully some more folks are joining in on the hexing that have not been hexing before, and it sounds like that is currently the case the last few weeks. We've been garnering some attention, which is nice.
Oh, heck yeah.
Yeah.
It's been great seeing fresh folks in the chat. It's been good seeing a lot of fresh folks coming in here and joining our Twitch community. Not just at a streamer level, but just as a new folks coming in and, you know, enjoying the experience, talking with folks. It's been great seeing new folks in our chat, seeing them in other folks' chat. A lot of good stuff going on there.
All right, so at least here's something for chat to engage with us on while we're working our way through the official news, because that'll probably be pretty quick. But I do want to hear from people on one thing that I've been wondering about is, of the cards that are currently existing in Hex, which of them do you feel would best, like, which of them would you like to see represented as an encounter or dungeon? So, like, we saw a lot of cards or champions that already existed become champions within the Frostering Arena and do all that fun stuff. And now we saw some of them become, like, there's the Warlock of Aether encounter in Craven Castle, if you're playing as humans. And, you know, there's a bunch of other cards out there that are starting to get encounters. Is there a particular, like, flavorful card that you would like to see become an encounter? And there's something to think about. That just popped into my head. I don't know if we've talked about that before, but, yeah.
All right.
But anyways, let's move on with official news, and then once we're done with official news, we'll talk about a little contest we ran.
Okay. So one of the first things for official news is, did you know they released an actual official trailer that we totally skimmed over last week and probably should have talked about?
I think I kind of saw it, but not until after the fact. Yeah, I definitely saw it. But yeah.
We're gonna hit that link up there in the chat.
Mm-hmm.
It's really well put together. I love the sounds. They have a female voiceover that is really, really good for the voice of, I believe, I pronounce it Mia. Mm-hmm. Of course, it could be a
Maya or something like that.
Yeah, or Maya, but I like pronouncing it as Mia because I'm a terrible pronunciator. So I think they have a really good voiceover for their a lot better than their 100K video. Oh my god, so much better than the 100K.
Yeah, here, I'm gonna bring up I clicked the wrong thing. There we go. I'm gonna bring up just run this in the background on muted while we're talking about this and the other things. We'll run it back here for people to see who might have missed it. But this is the video for their trailer, and it's pretty cool. We'll start back at the beginning. But yeah, so this goes. So I thought it was pretty cool. I thought the animations in there were good, and they're pretty, like, some of them are pretty simple, just like, you know, giving movement to some of the cards, but it is kind of cool to see what would normally be like a static object be given some movement or depth, and mm-hmm. some of the stuff looks really good, like the intro going on to the battle board, like, that looks better than the battle board that we get to play with, like, that's pretty fancy looking. But I like this, and I like this part that's about to happen with the hex shard. I think that's pretty cool. But
I mean, that looks like it could definitely be like just like your intro video into hex itself.
Yeah, like
watching this pretty, come down.
Exactly. Yeah, exactly. Right. This needs to play the first time you load hex. Like, this is pretty mm-hmm. cool. I feel like they need to do more stuff like this. They're missing out. But I like it quite a bit. Yeah.
Yeah, and it's you know, I really. Because there's a couple things, like, you can tell how there's a use of some of the older assets, like mm-hmm. One of those, one of the old Venom backgrounds,
yeah.
The Venom background being used, how some of the card art's definitely being animated, pulled together.
Mm-hmm.
I will say, when it comes to one of the avatars that they were showing there, mm-hmm. when it's, because you know he's a sapphire avatar, but when you see that big piece of white rock come around, you're just like, that's not a sapphire. That's a diamond. I don't know why that keeps getting me every time. I'm just like, that's a diamond. That's a diamond. That's not a sapphire. That's a diamond. There could probably be white sapphire because I'm not a good, you know, I'm not even remotely a geologist or know nothing about stones. But that looks like a diamond.
So
one day I'll get over it, I think.
I think this very last part where, like, the planet goes in their hand is a little bit goofy. There's something that doesn't quite work for me there, and, like, her tossing the cards. But, I mean, it like, that's not so bad, but it's mainly, like, when she has the planet in her hand and then it disappears. Like, maybe if I was watching again with the sound going, but I didn't quite understand what was trying to happen there, rather than it just showing stuff off. But the video is pretty cool. I definitely like especially the very beginning of the video, and now we will go ahead and close that.
We have a wild dated dragon in channel. Oh, watch out for your baby Yetis.
This is all your baby Yeti cards in a chest with that one you wanted. Very nice. I like it. But yeah, so what do we got going on? Blamstack encounter. Blamstack encounter would be kind of interesting. Like, that would kind of work too, because they could, like, it's using your stuff against you, kind of, or maybe, like, mm-hmm. You're racing against the clock kind of thing, or you need to, another part is kind of like Blamstack is if you meet conditions, you get to keep it kind of thing. Mm-hmm. And it continues doing damage. So maybe there's like a bunch of different things that are, doing damage or obstacles that are facing you all simultaneously. And you need to try to whittle as many of them away as you can, before it's too late. That'd be kind of neat. But, so what was Dragon attacks, you lose all your Baby Yeti cards and any chests with that one card you wanted. Oh, that's a bummer. Well, luckily, I think the one card I want isn't in a chest, it's in one of those adventure packs, so, hopefully we'll be getting some of those instead. But yeah, so we got, we have the video going on. Our next mm-hmm. piece of little, news on the main site is we have, another recent developments article on the main site, and I want to just forward. I want to say this at the, right off the bat, as I am so glad they are putting out these articles like this. They're doing them about like once every 2 or 3 weeks, and these are great. I want to continue seeing these. These are one of my favorite things. I am very glad that they have decided to make this part of their like website plan, that they are giving people insight or just letting employees kind of talk about something related to the game that they wanted to talk about, because I personally really enjoy reading these, and I think a lot of people out there do, but I can really only speak to myself. So,
So it's a good read, hands down, worth reading. Get in there, nose around a little bit. And while I was actually taking a second look at everything, I was going in and I'm like, oh, wow, here's this, you know, really awesome picture of the Adventure Zone with all the stuff, you know, kind of written, drawn out. And I'm like, okay, I get, like, all right, so this is kind of a gate. It goes over here. You know, I encounter. All right, I think I understand that. Hey, what's this other offshoot that I don't think I see?
I have a feeling like, it might have been an offshoot on there. Let me read this. Where, which offshoot that are you? Are you?
So it's under it's under step two map design, is where the picture is at.
Oh,
and so right from
the one that he's holding. You mean?
Yeah.
Okay. So yeah. So the, I see the picture, and there's part of it branching off that you don't recognize.
Yeah. So you see, it's just after bridge one, and it looks like it's supposed to actually be after the second traveling tent city.
The second.
It looks like it branches off from that node.
The little red thing going down?
Yeah.
No, that isn't that where the dwarf city is? I don't think that's anything.
You're right. That is actually where that is. Okay. well,
never mind.
I have to always double check because sometimes I'm crazy.
You got super excited about secret dungeon nodes that weren't there.
Well, it doesn't help that I was also on my elf character when I was looking at it again.
Okay.
And not my shin hair.
I was about to say, because I hadn't looked at it in depth and been like, oh, there is a spoiler on there, is that if there was something, I would almost feel that on the dungeon map, like kind of up by where the Smoldering Keep area is, on the upper area, there's like that plant encounter. And it feels like that plant encounter should lead to like two or three more plant-based encounters and maybe a plant-based dungeon. But it doesn't, and I figured maybe there was something spoilery with that, but
well, yeah, it was definitely one. I'm like, is there anything I missed? Do I think I saw everything? Do I think I've been anywhere? And I'm like, I remember that node.
Yeah, I think
is that
so.
A green node?
I think everybody probably went and looked alongside me when you said that, and we all got
okay.
Dated by
so in the picture, there's a little green node.
Okay, let me go bring up the picture again. All right, little green node where?
So there's a little green node. So it's after you cross the bridge. It's just after the robot. And so branching down from the robot, it looks like there's a little green arrow down with a little X towards the bottom side of it. So north.
Okay.
I don't know what that is, and I might go double check that here in a little bit.
Okay, so actually on that, right? So
yeah.
There's actually two nodes that are placed differently than what we're used to, I think. Maybe not. So maybe you're right. Maybe it looks like a shroom house or something over there. I don't know. Maybe, I think...
Green node is, so FRS says that green node is the Thunderfield.
Yeah, I think they might be right.
Oh, and it's exclusive to the Kyodle. Oh, that might be why I don't know about it. I haven't played a Kyodle through yet.
Okay.
I see. Learn a little bit every time.
Okay, so there you go. See, so there were some hidden stuff in there, perhaps, if you played one way and not the other. But I don't think there's anything that, like, isn't known or that didn't quite make it kind of thing in there.
Well, so I actually really, really like that, though.
Yeah.
Because if you haven't played the Kaido yet, you look at that and you're like, there's a node I haven't been to. I've played Ardent. I've played Underworld. Why don't I know where this node is? Why haven't I been able to find it yet?
Yeah.
There's something wrong here.
But yeah, but let's get back on track with talking about the article itself is oh, what am I gonna grab here? I think I'll grab that guy. But talking about the article itself, there's some pretty cool. Oh no, I shouldn't have gone that. I don't even have a diamond. Epic fail function, but it's all good. But yeah, there's definitely some cool stuff in there, and I still think I need to swap this gem because I also don't have ruby in there. And it's kind of interesting to get their insight on kind of the thematics of how things develop in the Adventure Zone a little bit. Talking about the one of my favorite encounters in there, the Smashing Pumpkins field, and even Lorgoyle added a little bit of a snippet onto the forum post related to the article itself about Snoodly and the art involved with that, which was kind of a fun little read. But yeah,
Oh my
so that's
goodness, I totally missed that. I'm glad I
yeah,
gotta go
you have to
find
go
it.
and check that out. Here, I'll even grab you the link for it. Let me go find it real quick. So it's actually it should be really easy
Adventure!
to find. I think it's in here. Yeah, because I was like, because I said something about the Smashing Pumpkins thing in there, and he said, yeah, that was a long time coming, basically for that piece of art. They had it laying around, and they decided to that they still wanted to use it. So there was some fun stuff there. All that good times.
Heck yeah.
Alrighty, so what were we gonna say? So we have all of that. We also have the playmat announcement, more or less with all of that, which I am. Those playmats are pretty fancy. Like the thing is like it's hard for me to personally be excited about a playmat because I don't really have an opportunity to use them. But that one is really cool looking. So.
My desk is adorned with playmats,
Sure. That's a
and
great opportunity to use
it
them.
is an they won. They're excellent mouse pads.
Yeah.
Hands down, like the one I got from Gen Con is awesome and I love the tar out of it. And like way back in the day, I have an old WoW TCG one and I like them. And that one will go. And I have one of the newer WoW TCG ones right here. We got like four spread across this crazy desk setup I've got
Nice,
going on. I
nice. I
can't
like
wait to
it.
add another one to it.
That's a good way to do it. Like I feel like if I had my own like room of being able of like computer room, like my own office, I would probably have a couple of the play mats alongside my posters on the wall or something like that. That'd be pretty nifty to be able to do. But yeah. So the play mats are definitely going to be a thing at the Invitational, and they will also come with a sleeve code, I'm pretty sure it sounds like. So people will be even
The
more
poster comes with the sleeve
yeah, or
code.
not sleeve code. Oh, the poster comes with the sleeve code,
Yeah,
not the play
poster
mat.
comes with the
Got it, got
sleeve
it, got it.
code.
Yeah.
The playmat is just some awesomeness.
But yeah, either way, it's still awesome. No doubt about that. And I want one. And hopefully I will be able to convince somebody to pick me one up and me send something back their way. So we'll make that work. But what else were we gonna say? So we have all that. One other thing that I was just thinking about the other day is what we're kind of talking about events coming up and the Invitational is Gen Con. Tickets, signups, or reservations, whatever you might call them, are already live. And they haven't started, like, Gen Con itself hasn't put events out or anything yet, but we haven't heard anything yet from the Hex team, whether they're going to be at Gen Con or what the representation like is going to be there. But I am excited to find out when we do know, because I'm all about that. So.
Jedi is just throw down the gauntlet. Well, Jedi, you are going to be participating in the tournament. You
Yeah.
won't have a chance to get off a stage while I'm buying up all those
Well,
posters with Colin. Thank you.
but JJ did he did promise me because he said he felt really bad that he was able to go that he made it all the way and I didn't that I lost in the finals so he's gonna give me his invitational sleeves the special ones which was
Oh,
really nice of him to give
nice.
those to me so we'll see if JJ responds to my trolling but but yeah I think that's perhaps one of the more salty parts that I'm saltier about is those sleeves are fancy and I will not be able to acquire them but it is what it is what are you gonna do all right but why don't we talk about our contest because it's about time that we had 41 entries in the contest. Let me bring the screen back up in that Hex is gonna be pause for a moment while I look at some of the entries. There were some really good entries in here. It seemed like a lot of people, well, Yeah, Mokog, why don't we get the link up as I introduce it? Where is it? Here's the link. I will toss that up in there. The sleeves are hype, indeed. All right, so this is for our little card design contest that spurned off of last week. And we were talking about avatars and how much we liked the avatars that are in Hex and some of the really cool designs. And we were kind of talking about other things. And wouldn't it be fun to have an avatar cowardice? Jokingly, we said, and a whole bunch of people came up with some really fun ones, and so we turned into a contest. 41 people came up with a, well, actually 42, because I tossed one in there too, but I'm not entering the raffle. 41 people entered into the raffle with their avatar of cowardice design, and everybody, for the most part, did a really great job of maintaining the humor that was intended with this whole thing, that it wasn't really necessarily meant to be super serious. You know, the card could be a viable card, but humor was obviously also very important with it, and some people came up with some pretty great submissions, I would say. Yeah.
Oh yeah, there's some really, really snazzy ones there for sure.
And let me see, there was some, like, the thing is, so we said we're going to raffle off the prize, and I'm glad that we decided to just raffle it, because I don't think I would be able to choose. It would take me, I would have to just stare at these for a long time, and we're only drawing two winners, but I think if I had to choose, we would end up going up to like 8 or 9 winners, because there were just too many good ones in here. Were some that were like references to like pop culture stuff, with a Monty Python one in there, and the dice cow was one in here. There was a Xenoveers was really good. Yeah, the Thrawn's Brave Sir Robin I really liked quite a bit. Angel of Anxiety was maybe one of my favorite names for one of them. There were some really, really great names in here, which I came up with one or two cards, but I couldn't come up with good names for them at all. But Angel of Anxiety is perhaps one of my favorites. It makes me think of something out of like a Mel Brooks movie or something. But yeah, it's good times. There are a lot of great entries in there. I suggest people, if they want to laugh, should go through and read some of these submissions, because they're pretty great. I really enjoyed it. I was surprised that so many people wanted to submit entries in there, and I really liked it. But you have anything else to say on our Avatar of Cowardice notes here, Mopo?
Our community loves making cards, and God bless every one of them, because it's awesome.
For sure. But yeah, so there was some good stuff in here. Let me double check one thing. All right, so I will go ahead and have the raffle for that. First, before we do, it's definitely about time that we have the draft code raffle. So let me bring up the thing for this. The raffle for the Avatar of Cowardice contest. We're not going to require people to be in channel for that. We're just going to draw it, and I will find their info somehow. But I'll still need you to... why am I having trouble with the XSplit? I'll still need you to write down their name for me. All right, so we're going to go ahead and do screen capture here. Get this going. All right, so we're going to go ahead and roll those dice, see who the lucky winner here of a draft code is. We'll just need them to respond in chat, and then we'll whisper it on over to them. But yeah, thanks guys for hanging out with us tonight on Journal's Tent. Excited to be streaming again and talking about Hex and all that other good stuff that entails. So here we go. Dead Jack Pitt, once again, you are the winner of a draft code here. Just need to hear from you in chat that you're still around, and then we will get that sent on over your way. But yeah. So we're all caught up now with news. We've gotten that segment out of the way. So now we're kind of edging ourselves into talking about the fun stuff. In the meantime, though, before we do that, so Dead Jack Pitt, he responded. I'm going to go ahead and have the drawing for the two winners on the contest. Let me see. Random number generator on the web. So I have them all assigned in a spreadsheet. Let me just draw some random numbers between 1 and 41. All right, so random we're going to do number 32 and number 17 in the numbers. So I will give you the names here. It is Knight of Effect and Xenoveer, actually, is the other winner. So those guys, and Xenoveer's was pretty good. All right, so those two are the winners on the thing for that. Let me
So that was 17 and 31?
yeah, or 17 and 41.
41.
Was that right? No. I said 31. 31. Yeah.
Okay. Now I'll have their numbers as well as their names.
Yep. All right, so we got that going. And let me bring up their cards here. Might as well see what the winners submitted, and we'll read those ones off here. So let me bring up the thread again because I closed it. And where are we going? Avatar Cowardice design. So we're looking for Xenevir's first submission, which I think was kind of deep in there. I have them in order. All right, one more here. All right, so his was Hamlet, a triple wild troop, Avatar of Cowardice. It was four resources, and it has lethal. It says if Hamlet would be destroyed, void it instead, and it deals one damage to a random troop. And since it has lethal, it would kill that troop, I would assume. If Hamlet is in the void at the start of your turn, you may offer him a treat. If you do, put Hamlet into play under your control. If you do not, put Hamlet into play under a random opposing champion's control. So whenever if Hamlet is in the void at the start of your own turn, you can offer him a treat to get him to come out, it sounds like. And the treat is to offer him a treat, randomly void a card in your deck, hand, or graveyard. And if you get to choose like where it comes from, that makes things you like always would do your crypt or always do your deck. You would never do your hand. But and then the flavor text says this little piggy went to the market, this little piggy went home, and Hamlet got the hell out of Dodge. So I like that one quite a bit. Let's check out Knight of Effect was the other one, I believe. And let's find where his was on here. Maximum Squid. Knight of Effect was the Fairweather Rider, a troop of cowardice, which cannot block. It was four resources, two Sapphire Threshold. If this is blocked, remove it from combat. It gets a ra at random, either -1, -0, flying, or unblockable. So, and that's whenever it is blocked, it gets one of those. So, you know, if it gets unblockable, that's pretty decent. If it gets flying, that's pretty decent because it can't. It's going to be less likely to be blocked anymore. But if it gets -1, then it's going to be in trouble because it, like. It attacking isn't doing a whole lot. And it finally says when this deals combat damage to an opposing champion, it gets opposing troops cannot b block.
That's not too bad.
Yeah, so I'm guessing it means. Yeah, so that's worded a little bit strangely, but I think I get what he's getting at is that. Yeah, so when it deals damage to an opposing champion, there, the opposing troops. Huh. Yeah, so
Basically,
can
gain cowardice and they can't.
gain cowardice, or is it his own troops are gaining cowardice? One or the other. But the flavor text is by air, by land, by sea, I will dominate all of Entrath as long as a stiff wind doesn't scare me. That's pretty good. I like it. But yeah, so there were some good submissions in there, a lot of really great flavor text. And yeah, thanks to everybody who offered submissions in there because I really enjoyed that contest and I had a blast with it.
Oh, most yes. Full of sweet, snazzy bait commits.
Let me get Howdy FCC Mocog in function. Well played, sir. I like it. So we got that going on. Let me bring up the draft code for him and get that sent out. All right, so then we're gonna
Draft
send this over
code.
to Dead Jack, and then we'll get moving on with the show again. Whisper to Dead Jack. There we go. And hey, Hacky. All right. All right, so that is whispered on over to Dead Jack Pitt. Congratulations on the draft code win. Good luck in your draft. Hopefully, you do well there. And in the meantime, we'll continue moving on. So now we're kind of talking about the fun stuff, talking about just what we do every week and our engagement. So what do we're saying for our weekly topic is our favorite PvE deck. Is that that's
Yep,
what we're
as
talking
well
about?
as one of the other ones that we added as well.
Okay. Which is it's not the chat checkup in there, right? That was the oh, I know what the weekly topic that I was saying to add at the beginning of the
Yes.
show. I didn't write it in on my end. I'm a baddie.
Well, I wrote it in on my end, so
Yeah,
that's a good
so
part.
it was a good thing you remembered because I would have totally forgotten, and it was something that I wanted to talk about. So yeah, nice.
So the first part is, you know, I think it's still pretty fun to talk about the various PvE decks that are that we're pulling together out there. One of which I saw on the forums because it's a little thread that blew up, the Dream deck.
Yeah.
So as you know, We are a community very occupied with dreams.
Mm-hmm.
Definitely from those who happen to hail from the Clampians. And so one of the not the first, but maybe the second dungeon,
mm-hmm.
Is where you go into, it's not called the Tranquil Dream. That's a different thing. But basically you go into the tent, you're in kind of a dream state, and it is, you know, kind of the surreal you're going through. Well, the drops from that have really good equipment when you start actually pairing them out with the cards.
Yep, they sure do.
And you can do a lot of crazy stuff.
Dream Eagle OP.
So, I mean, there's definitely some shenanigans going on there. Mm-hmm. And even if you can only partially build that deck, it still can be really interesting to play with a partially built out one.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm trying to put together that deck at this point.
All right.
And one of the things that I think that is very significant about the Dream Deck is that it shows that there are definitely themed decks built into the experience.
Yeah, absolutely.
That as we, you know, go through and start acquiring those cards and start putting in together some of those obvious themes.
Yeah, I mean, like, that's kind of something they've always done, whether it was, like, Plants or whether it was, like, the Slaughter Gear deck or all these other things that are out there. They definitely kind of had these decks that, in a sense, like, are kind of... easy to assemble the pieces, at least mentally. Like,
well, you can see, I would say, like, it's obvious they go together.
It's not necessarily easy to acquire all the pieces, I guess, is where I should
ask everyone who's wanting to get a storm coat.
Yeah, yeah.
How easy things are to put together.
Totally. But yeah, so I mean, those things are definitely pretty rad. And I like the dream cards. And I would love to own a Enter the Dream, which I think it sounds like there are some bug fixes probably on the horizon based on a few of the threads on the forums. And I can imagine that getting those available on the auction house is probably among the things that is going to be getting done.
Yes. So I know a lot of people are doing their trading and their purchasing right now for PvE cards through the trade chat.
Yeah.
God bless all of you, because that is a labor of love to try to pull that together.
For sure.
You know, we have a lot of ways to facilitate that. Just think about all of the consternation that you have trying to sell your cards through trade chat and the forums right now.
Mm-hmm.
And that's exactly why we have an auction house.
Yep. That's very true. Especially with, like, the more people that start playing the game, kind of the faster chat will continue to flood by. Oh, did I really just do that? I voided my own Argus because I was only halfway paying attention. So I clicked it to, like, activate his power, and then I was like, oh, no, I don't want to do it after all. So I clicked him again to, like, turn it off. But that's not what happened. It just voided himself. So that was pretty pro plays right there. We're still in perfectly fine shape. But I enjoy that I just did that, because that was, you know, amusing. That was painful.
So the now bright side is that we now have a fully functioning trade chat.
Mm-hmm.
So that is definitely a real plus. You know, you can jump over there and trade. In fact, we have someone who's wanting to buy an Eternal Sage for 700 platinum. So, hi, Wingspear!
Yeah.
Just randomly opening a trade chat there. General definitely flies by a lot more than it used to.
Mm-hmm.
I like that there's a help channel. I think it, like, directly goes to the nobles.
Mm-hmm.
So you just want to yell at them, that's totally the way to go.
Nice.
You know, it's just a lot of... You know, seeing more the additional functionality coming into the chat, watching it go into its own, I always find that to be super awesome and very, very good.
Mm-hmm.
So it still doesn't replace that auction house, though.
Yeah.
That auction house is supremo necessary, in my opinion. And it's one of those is I've gotten very used to just how easy it facilitates the interpersonal trades. It's just like, even though you may not necessarily get the most accurate, it's not the right word, but even though it may not be tuned for best price, so to speak, and mm-hmm. that there may be better auction methods out there,
sure.
for all of our folks who are very much efficiency and money minded.
Yeah, that's a good way to put it.
It still serves its purpose very well.
Yeah,
in that
it does.
you know, it gets the point across.
If you're looking for a card, you will be able to find that card. Like, that, yes. That's the important part. And you have access to the stuff you want. You know, if you want to try to find Finagle a way to get it cheaper or something like that, you can put in the effort and do that. But at least the stuff that you want to be out there, it is out there. And, you know, you can find a way to access it one way or another. What did I get? I got Infiltrate, Troops of Control, and the Steel Sandwich. Yep, all right, that's fine. And it's time to bash with that massive Azawa that is just going to get bigger and bigger. Very nice. But yeah.
All right. So I think now when it comes to like other PvE decks, though, I think I really want to take the Stormcloud deck in. I haven't actually tried running that through legitimately yet. I don't know if it's something that I want to try running with elves. I don't know if I want to try like running it with Kyoto, or maybe it'll work better with dwarves since a lot of it happens to be Ruby Sapphire based. That's a lot of questions I don't have every answer to yet.
Sure.
But still looks really, really awesome in thought. Hopefully it's super awesome in practice. I've seen a couple folks trying to bring that one together.
Is this new? So clicking Soul Marble? I mean, that's definitely not always been a thing. Is you going to sign
that was an update.
Yeah.
Yep. Huh. That was one of the new quality of life updates for Soul Marble.
Huh. That's pretty cool. I like that. That definitely makes things nice. I mean, there's definitely still times where you want to do it one at a time, where that's your best choice. Where, you know, if you think your opponent's going to interact with you in some way, or if, like, your resources are just cut out that you need to hold them back on a certain point along the Soul Marble evolution so that if they are going to interact with you, you can still activate Soul Marble enough to turn it online. But that's pretty cool. I like that. Will this work? Uh-oh. Infiltrate doesn't seem like it wants to work. That's not good.
No! Uh-oh. Infiltrate!
Yeah, I think we,
Did you just break the game?
I think I just broke the game. But that's what General Standard is
for. And you're in a commanding position.
Yeah, I was in a wonderful position. So what did I... So, I played the card, and it did not appreciate that. Ouch. So, that was a thing. But what are you gonna do? There we go. So I guess I will exit out of that and find... I will have to submit a bug report because Infiltrate definitely was not appreciated that game. I don't know if it was something to do with me creating it with the Sky Mage or something else entirely, but that definitely just happened. All right, so we got that all going on. What were we saying? Everybody chatting.
I was like, hit the space bar a bunch. Throw a blanket over it. Build a fence around.
Yeah, I should have put it. I should have tried spamming the space bar a little bit. So we were talking about favorite PvE deck, right?
Yes.
What is your favorite PvE deck? We were talking about as the lead-in about all these other decks that are out there and like the kind of thematic decks where these cards just they belong together more or less, right? What is your favorite deck in general? It doesn't necessarily have to belong together.
I've had a lot of fun running with the Levitate Mage spec with Wild Ruby Ramp. I've had a lot of fun doing. One of the things is, because if you actually take that spec Elf, you know, they have Wild, they have Ruby, they're very legendary focused. That's the Wild Ruby Ramp is definitely a rare legendary heavy sort of deck.
Sure.
And so by level 9, you get a fairly consistent version of it, even though I'd really like to have more uncommons. Mm-hmm. Hint, hint, nudge, nudge, give me my uncommons by level 10, please. And one of the fun things about that, though, is that when you run the Levitate Mage method, you end up, when you put that with Elf, is you wind up with a good set of bounce that you're really not used to having in Ruby Wild, and it's really, really awesome.
That's pretty nice. Yeah, and like if you're running the Elf, activation to give one of your dudes +3/+3 is super clutch. Like that wins games so quickly. Whether it's like almost always removal, and it is very often also enough to get you lethal damage because it comes in at just the right time pretty often. So,
and depending on also how you spec your mage, you can get that +3/+3 online as early as turn 2. Sometimes early as turn 1, depending on a few things. And so one of the things I found a lot of fun is when you go Spell Sprite, you know, you Spell Sprite turn 1, you drop your shard, then you throw a Crackling Vortex, you get your spell power up to 7. You give it +3/+3. Now you have it in the air, 0 cost, 4, mm-hmm. 4.
Yeah. And those spell sprites are super good, too. I like those spell sprites.
And the other fun part is that you know, after it does its damage, you can bounce it back to your hand plate for free with your levitate and, pull another card off the top if you need to combo it out a little.
I think some of my favorite decks are these, like, 100-card decks. Generally, I would say, like, the decks that I don't normally get to play. Like, the decks that encourage you to do something kind of unusual or play with cards that are just, like, they're not the best cards. And so I kind of like playing with, like, a lot of these, like, suboptimal cards or just kind of using something that seems, I guess for lack of a better word, just fun and doing a lot of that. So that's, I think, where I'm getting most of my enjoyment from.
You know, this may be absolutely terrible, but PvE gives you a license to be a filthy casual whenever you want.
Yeah.
And you don't have to... you know, the main part of the story quest does not force you to necessarily have the maximum amount of power there, which is great for all of our free players because it means that they can go in the hardcore mode, essentially, and do a lot of great work. I know I've had a ton of fun going that way.
Since Satellution kind of gave a shout-out for the 100-card decks, too, part of what makes them interesting is... specifically with these, like, larger size decks, you can run those, like, Ethereal Healers and other cards similar to those that you probably wouldn't want to put in a 60-card deck. They might just not... might not be room for them. And really, you don't want to draw those cards. You just want them to be in your deck. And so when you're playing with more cards, the likelihood of you drawing them is even lower, which is another nice part of it. So, yeah.
I don't know how Penta did that, but that looks pretty cool.
What do you do?
Gorefeast into Triumvirate? I'm all right with that. Wow. I don't know how you did it, buddy, but good job.
So what was it? He played a Gorefeast and it popped out the Triumvirate? Is that what he's saying? The Triumvirate
into Gorefeast.
Nice.
So I'm all for it. Keep it up.
Yep. Very nice. Ouch. But it sounds like a lot of people are saying more or less the same things. There's less disincentive to try fun new combos. Yeah, a lot of the time I'll just play a couple encounters in PvE, and I won't have really gotten very far before I go, hey, I got a really fun deck idea. And then I just end up building decks for the next 2 hours and realize that I never actually went back to playing. I'm not actually, like, upset about that. I think that's what I wanted to do, so that's what I did. Mm-hmm. And I like that I'm able to enjoy the game in that way as well, I guess, is what I'm getting at. So.
Yeah, it's a... So not only... One of the fun parts I'm also finding is that the classes start really feeling distinct as you get a little bit deeper into your trees.
Yeah, yeah.
Some of them are, like, distinct right off the bat. Like, Cleric feels really distinct off the bat. Warrior feels super distinct off the bat. I think Mage really starts coming to its own towards, you know, level 8, level 9, once you really start getting into your, start finding ways to start generating your spell power a little bit easier. But once you've got those guys, you know, rocking and working, it is some serious awesome sauce when they're doing their thing.
Here's an equipment that is actually kind of interesting. So Shard Call. The equipment for it says your shard calls instead have search your deck for a resource and put it into your hand. So rather than creating one, you're taking them out of your deck and potentially making your deck more consistent. And I think that's pretty cool. I don't know, like, how worth a card slot that is, but Trinket in a lot of my decks is usually, like, not being put to the best use. So I kind of feel like, you know, shard call might be more of a consideration because of that. Like, it's just thinning your deck out even more, which is never a bad thing. And it might even let you be able to run fewer resources overall in your deck if the shard calls basically always count as one. Interesting, especially if you're doing, like, a mono diamond deck.
So, one of the things Penta brings up is actually a very good point there.
Mm-hmm.
What type of resource does it say you can get?
Oh, does it not say basic? Did I completely overlook that? It just say grab a resource and put it into your hand? I am going to go see that for myself and eat my words, because that's pretty cool if that's what it does. All right, so shard I guess I gotta type it in. There's a ton of words that have, or cards that have shard in there. Alright, so it's search your deck for any resource and put in your hand. Oh, that is pretty good. That's a lot better. That's, like, I was already pretty on board with it. That's way better. Like, you can find your crackling vortex, and even more importantly, I expect, you know, rare, very good rare shards to continue coming out at some point, where you are building a deck that, you know, really relies on some of the shards it might play. And in that case, this is, like, a slam dunk card for you, because you're going to be able to find that shard that you really need that does something interesting. Maybe. I mean, if they take the game that direction at some point. But I hope they do, because it's a cool space to operate out of. And I would definitely... that's pretty cool. I'll have to keep an eye on that as more shards are released and everything.
Well, I mean, one of the obvious ones, it's very good to shard called into Sepulchre Cryptdust.
Yeah.
That's... So, you know, the idea being is that you're trying to hit your five shards deck, and so you... your shard call, you're getting that non-basic resource for whatever fixing you're needing.
Yeah.
So...
Yeah, give me Wild West. Wild West before multiplayer. Wild West is, we need to get it, armies. It needs to happen.
Yeah. Oh my even goodness, I'm going to do so many fun things
even with if Wild it's West just an it. Optional thing that you can toggle on in the Proving Grounds, RIP Proving Grounds, just an optional
one
thing.
One day it'll come back.
You can toggle on, and not necessarily like a competitive mode that you're playing in tournaments. Even if it's just something that you can do casually, I would be all about that. I want it so badly, and I would really, really love that. I'm on board. And that shard call equipment is pretty real. Also, I think everybody would just be fitting Dream Eagles into their deck as well.
Oh my goodness. I love Dream Eagle and its equipment.
Well, it's worded to take the resource out of your deck, whether it does in effect, you know, sometimes there's bugs, so it should be taking it out, to answer your Besmagas question. But yeah, so we got that going on. I think it's time we have another raffle here. You want to do the convocation stack, and then we'll move on to our second kind of topic of the week?
Convocation sounds like a plan.
All right, so I'm going to bring up the raffler here. We're going to go ahead and draw this for the convocation stack. We'll need to hear from the winner there, and Mokog will give them the rundown of what they need to tell us. All right, so there it is. Sad Illusion wins the convocation stack. So for being... Down. He got it rigged for being a participant in chat. Seems like it is his lucky day. So give him the rundown, Mokog.
All right, Sad Illusion. You have been here before, but this may be your first or possibly your second win on here. So one of the things we've got going on with the convocation stack is I have a beautiful stack of cards that I am shuffling right now. And we're going to take the top five of these cards and let you choose between 1 through 5. Function will also pick a number. Function has a tendency to either pick terrible equipment or sleeves.
It's almost always the like the boots or whatever the one that nobody wants is, or sleeves.
Umbrella.
Umbrella, okay.
Yeah, so we're going to put out these five here. Now, the reason we do the top five is that one of the things I've noticed is I have a tendency to end up having a sleeve code in the top five cards. And there was one time we had 4 sleeve codes in the top
five
cards.
That was pretty real. Yeah.
So, Sadolution, you are picking 5. So you're picking this card right here. Sadolution knows what's up. He's ready to go. The question is, Function, what's your number?
So he's picking 5? I almost want to... I can't pick his number. I'm going to go with 2.
You want to go with 2?
Yeah,
all right. So we're going to start from 1, skip Functions, see the others. We're going to do Sad Illusion. We're going to do yours last. So card number 1. Would have been lucky. That would have been a sleeve today. Well, there's telling you, there's. I don't try to make this happen. Yeah. There's almost always a sleeve in the top 5 now. I'm sure mathematics would solve that.
Was there last week? I don't remember. I don't think there was.
There was not last week. Yeah. Last week was the first week when there wasn't. Let's try 3. 3 would have been a Cloud Queen, a very good card. I mean, it's not like the best card in the world, but it's still a very good card.
Mm-hmm.
Now, number 4 would have been the Slippers of the Cloud Queen. Your Cloud Queens would have had -1 cost. Fun equipment, very good for when you're trying to put together the deck because it drops those down to, I believe, a 3 cost? Mm-hmm. Yeah, to 3 cost, which is a great spot for the Cloud Queen to be. So, Function, what do you think you picked today?
What do I think I picked?
Yes.
I think I picked a storm coat that's not in there, but you're going to give it to me? No. So what do I think I picked? I'm going with the good old classic. I picked an umbrella.
You actually picked a Cloud Queen this week.
Okay.
So, you know, troop, useful. There was two Cloud Queens, set of umbrellas, and a sleeve that, oh, my poor sweet Satolution, you do not get an opportunity at this week. But unless, of course, this final one happens to actually be something super amazeballs. Satolution's like, I clearly have a coat. Well, let's find out. We're going to Star Wars. This is do copyright strike. And
what is that?
It is a Lantern of the Cloud Queen. Very Cloud Queen theme this time.
Yeah, yeah.
So this one, his Cloud Queens will have instead when this enters play to create a storm cloud and put into play. Actually, a really crucial part of that deck.
I have a quick question. Has everybody actually heard the sound that the Fennec Fox makes? Because if you haven't, I suggest you boot up your client and go play some PvE and turn the sound on for the Ambling Bluff encounter. Because that Fennec Fox sound is, it just makes me laugh every time I hear it. So, yeah, I figured I would share that. All right, so Satolution, you got that that lantern. And
So Satolution saying, keep it in the stack to troll the other winners.
Oh.
Well, that being the case, Satolution, give me your IGN anyway. We'll at least send you a booster pack.
Yeah, there you go. That's a good price. All right, so you got that going. But, all right, so what do we... Peace Singer saying 2000. Can anyone tell me roughly how many chests I need to spend to get either the rare or legendary Slaughter Gears? You know what? I've gotten three of the legendary Slaughter Gear ones, and I still don't have a single one of the Reavers, which is kind of like you would think I would have gotten an even mix, but apparently not the case with my luck. But yeah, so we got that going on. Talking about those chests rolling. I was rolling a bunch of my common chests the other day, but no longer. No, there's no worker bot or whatever here on the official channel. We gotta get that fixed at some point. But yeah, so we got that going on. And next, this was something I want to talk about. I don't know how much real back and forth there is about this, unless you know, maybe there's some interesting input we might have from chat or from you that makes it turn into an interesting conversation. Because otherwise, I think it's just more of a statement, and it might not be so much of a topic to talk about, but we do have set four on the horizon here pretty close. One of the questions that a lot of people have been wondering are is whether the players at the Invitational will be playing with set four or not. I would imagine that if they were going to be, we would have started seeing more spoilers already for set four. So my gut at this point is telling me that they won't be, but they might still be doing it as a big reveal. Though, I think finally, on that note, thing I'll say is, if they're meaning it to be an extremely competitive tournament, and kind of like the pinnacle of everything, kind of sending players in there blindly might not be the best way to do it, if that makes sense. It might be still a really fun way for all of those guys to do surprise set four draft, but not have it be part of the actual, sanctioned element of the tournament. It would be fun to still see that happen. It would be a nice little historical moment for all those guys to participate in, especially if it was being streamed. But I'm not sure how I like what I think about it. Grant, it doesn't really matter what I think because I'm not participating. But JJ over there, and Satolution too. Satolution's going, isn't he? Or am I thinking of somebody else?
Satolution is, he, in fact, if I remember correctly, took the final spot.
Yeah.
So here's the fun part about that. So the draft segment has not been declared yet, but can be declared to be set for, and the players will find out, not necessarily us, but the players will find out 2 weeks before the tournament.
Okay.
If it's going to be.
Very cool.
Well, the current hypothesis is that they'll basically get like a full spoiler list on what they, you know, what would be there, you know, what things are, what ready, et cetera, so that they have those 2 weeks to prepare. Okay. That's the idea. That part's not in the rules, but, you know, that's the, you know, you're getting warned beforehand that that's coming. So the draft segment only. Now, the constructed segments, which is the first day as well as the second half of the second day, those are both constructed set three or set one, two, and three.
Okay, so that's known for sure. That makes sense. That way, they would have enough time, because like if it was sprung on them, they would have to have a spoiler and potentially have help from teammates to build stuff. But if they're under an NDA on the spoiler, it kind of throws things off. I think that's a decent way to accomplish that.
And is it possible? Yes. Will they? Unconfirmed, but still a definite possibility.
So,
would it be really interesting to see the top eight going at a 4-4-3 draft for the first time, and that's what we're seeing? I'm a little mixed on that.
Kind of the same reasons that I was saying, you mean?
Well, one of the reason that I'm a little mixed on that is because it really throws your casters under the bus.
Oh, sure.
Because how are they going to know what is was really being a good pick at that point in time? Well, which also means your casters would also have to be brought in
part of it.
That,
yeah.
As part of their preparation. Mm-hmm.
But I think like with the casting crew that they have, they could easily make that like that part of it of them maybe not necessarily seeing the cards for the first time, because I would hope that if they did do that as draft, that they would have let the casters kind of see a lot of the spoilers too. But it would be probably their first time seeing it in action in draft, and they would that's like a good opportunity. That's like that definitely creates excitement for them and the audience, and I think could pull that off just fine.
What I would probably liken the experience to is I would liken the experience to unlimited equipment drafts that we did during Gen Con.
Yeah.
Where if you are very good in the limited format, you have a very good set of basics and understanding of what's going on, you'll be able to draft. But if you have to build your skill set through like hard work and figuring things out the hard way, you're at a significant disadvantage there.
Yeah. But, it is the pinnacle. It shouldn't be easy. Top. Yeah, it is the top. But then the other thing I was saying is kind of what we're both saying is like, does it, if it's blind playing the first, like that set four with drafting, if it's blind, is it really showcasing the pinnacle of competition? I guess is the real question. But let me see if either of those two guys already said anything. Okay, so they kind of addressed it, but JJ and Satolution, what do you think on just playing set four blindly when it comes to Invitational? Is it something that you would be reluctant to do, or would you be excited to do it? I'm interested to see from two people who it actually does matter. They would or would not be impacted. That's the first thing. It was actually a complete tangent on what we were going to be saying is potentially here. This is the real weekly topic that I'm getting into now is potentially being the key word is potentially this is the first set that will have been designed with the intent of it having 17 cards in a pack. Potentially they knew all along and it was all part of the plan. I highly doubt that, right? I think it was a more recent decision to change it. And with that said, now the real question is, was set four, they've been designing sets very far in advance, right? So set four might've been had at least some of the core designs done a year ago, we'll say. Maybe, I mean, that's just like an arbitrary number. Who knows? It might have been 6 months. It might have been a year and a half. Somewhere in that range. And maybe it was or was not for sure with the 17-card pack thing by that time. So it's potentially possible that it was or it was not originally designed. Then the next question is, even if it wasn't originally designed with it, did they perhaps go back and adjust things make it fit with 17 cards better, or are they just being like, no, 17, or like, or are adjustments like, is the 17 card thing even changing design at all from any perspective? Like, I'm definitely interested to like get insight on the design/development process with 17 card packs now, and how they feel on the inside, whether it's changed things or what kind of impact they feel it makes or they would like it to make kind of thing, or whether it gives them tools in some way or not. It's all kind of guesswork on my part, but I would definitely be interested to hear more about that. But what do you think with set four perhaps being designed around drafting finally now with 17 cards per pack? Do you have any input on
that? What I would wager, and this is a blind wager, because even though we we can reach out to the folks to get information. We're not on speed dial.
Yep, yep.
You know, they don't call us up whenever they have a question for anything. We are still schlubs for all intents and purposes. We are very charismatic schlubs who love talking to everyone, but we're still schlubs. But that being the case, what we do know is set three was well designed at 15 card packs, and we love the tar of it at 15 card packs. And the shift to 17 card packs for set three has its growing pains, is probably the best way to put it.
Sure.
You can feel a little bit more confident drafting it as a new player, but for those who were experienced it at 15, a lot of folks preferred it at 15 cards. Now, I would say from a design perspective, I would wager this is that it was designed for 15, and then it has been revised for 17.
Sure. I think, and this is the
and
first
that's my thought on there.
Yeah.
Because, you know, they would have had set four designed when things were still 15 card packs. Not everything through the timeline of the design process, whatever the final settlement needed to be with Voldemort, that not everything was known and how things were going to fall out. And then once it was discovered and then figured out, you can then take that and go back and redo your finishing touches. Make sure you've got your commons and uncommons properly balanced out along those ways, because you know that's one of the hardest parts about getting those design right. That part of the design is, you know, there's a certain expectation level for power in an uncommon, and we had a lot of really high powered uncommons in set three. With so many more of those now, what do you need to do to set four so that your 4/4/3 has a good feel to it now?
So, and JJ and Satellution, amongst others, are even chiming in on this. But real quick, before we go on that, they both kind of mentioned their thoughts here on things with set four perhaps being drafted in California. And I think Satellution really touched on the biggest part is, you know, whenever they patch out new stuff, there's going to be bugs, and the number of bugs is always more abundant when a new set launches. That if it was really buggy during the tournament, that would just create a bad experience for everybody, not only the players, but it would be a huge, like, I would say it would be a pretty bad PR blow if this is the pinnacle of competition as far as Hex has gone yet, right? We're hoping it continues that bell curve in the direction we want it to go. But this is the first, like, major thing. And if it was just ridden with bugs, that would be very depressing for everybody. So we don't want to see that.
Well, because we know Corey is an avid drafter. Mm-hmm. If Corey feels when he goes in and tests his set four draft experience that he is not happy with it, you could guarantee the top will not be playing with it.
Yeah, but I mean, like, even a small interaction that had impact on the game would be pretty unfortunate. Granted, they might be in a controllable enough environment that engineers might be able to be watching on the fly and, like, rewind stuff as necessary, which is something I hadn't really thought about until now. But if that was the case...
And they could play on the equivalent of dev machines that kind of stuff, and not have to worry about it necessarily being live and have, like, the most advanced builds where they've actually solved...
Yeah, have it
99.9% of bugs.
That's a good point. That's a really
so
good
could
point.
They pull it off? Yes, yeah. You could pull it off. Would it and not have to worry about it in the live environment and have it on your because you know they're going to be enclosed on there, so
yep.
They should be enclosed on there.
So we had that going, and then JJ kind of touching on something that I've been saying all along. But even with like 15 cards, right? I was saying the bar for that 23rd playable was already. Like, it was already easy to find 23 cards, much less, like, 27 or 28 cards that you were happy to put in your deck when it was 15 cards. And now that it's 17, there's been very many times where I've finished my deck where I'm completely happy with everything that's in it by the middle of Pack 2. Or times where I've drafted two completely different decks that share no cards between them. All kinds of, like, different things where, you know, in those cases, obviously, neither of the decks was as good as it could have been otherwise, or I wasn't maybe necessarily negating my opponent's options. But, like, I like that at one point in Hex, hate drafting was an important part of the process, and it's not really as necessary anymore. I'm not talking about like taking a rare that is good out of your opponent's hands. That's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking more about like neutralizing certain archetypes that might that you're not currently playing. And that's really kind of more along the lines of what I'm talking about. But yeah, that the bar for that 23rd card is just it's like I want it to be possible to draft build bad decks. That's what I've always said. I want it to be you know, if there's eight people at the table, I don't
I'm not gonna lie to you. You get me rare drafting and you will watch me draft a bad deck. We've done that live before, sir.
Well, I guess what I'm getting at is there's eight people in the pod. I don't think it should always be possible for all eight of those players to have an extremely good deck. Even if we're talking the pinnacle of competition here, right? If in California, if all of them are there, like, they should all have roughly, given out other, I know there's a lot of variables in drafting, but they should have roughly the same power level of draft if they're all, like, the best eight drafters there are, which isn't necessarily the case because there were different formats for qualifying and everything. And there's a little bit of luck involved in here and there. But, you know, they're the gap between deck power levels should be not as wide as it should be, more narrow than it normally would be in public drafts. But what I'm saying is, like, you shouldn't always have to have eight really strong decks in the draft. The drafting process should matter just as much as the gameplay does. And I think right now it most of the focus is on gameplay, which is great because gameplay is fun. But I think more focus should be on drafting and drafting well than it currently is. Is just my criticism, really. Yeah.
And just to express there is a counter side to that, and it's the other side of your standard player experience. When you have more of those cards in the draft that are playable, every new player who walks in and every fresh experience that comes in, they walk away with a higher degree of value that they can take home with them. There is an argument to be made for that as well.
Yeah. All right, now, so we're gonna play the Titania's Majesty.
I also want to see what happens when we play the Majesty.
Yeah, I've been sitting here on the screen forever because I got sidetracked talking about hex stuff, right? So we're gonna pull the trigger on this Titania's Majesty and see what we get. The gem has the ruby damage gem, and there's no ruby gems in this deck, so I should probably fix that. Whether it's taking out that particular gem out of this Titania's Majesty or putting a couple ruby sources in there somewhere. I kind of built this deck when I was tired and absent-minded, and these things happen. But let's see what we get. So we got Indrigo Dreamwalker. We got Thunderfield Elder that has a bunch of prophecy stuff on it, so that's probably what we're gonna get. And he's gonna continue prophesizing other stuff with flight and +2/+2 because he's just a boss like that. And he actually got plus an additional boost because of off of the Arcane Dreamcatcher, and it's fancy shenanigans that it pulls off. But yeah, that wasn't too bad. And the AI once again has trouble dealing with good old King Gabriel over there. But yeah, that was
maybe
that
the AI is not supposed to know how awesome King Gabriel is over there.
Mm-hmm.
He's just he just flashes the flag of Adamanth and everyone's just like, ah.
Okay, so Satolution here saying, I think drafting well is in fact important, especially when frequently releasing new sets. But since set 3 has been out for so long, that's part of the reason it has become less important. I think I agree with kind of the idea of what you're saying, but I don't think I agree with the full sentiment of that statement. Like, it's still along the curve, it's still possible for all eight people in the pod to have extremely good decks. And that's ultimately, like, I'm not sure if that should always be possible, is really my statement. I totally get what he's saying, too. Like, definitely as the set is out longer, everybody's experience level goes up significantly. That even the inexperienced, less good drafter will be doing better the more they play with it. And sure, their deck is going to be better just because of that experience they've had with the set and it's been out for so long. And that's obviously completely valid to be saying.
Function's totally not describing me at all.
All right, so let's finish off this Ambling Bluff here, and let's move on. What do we have as our next thing here? Really, I guess what we were talking about wasn't really much of a back and forth as I expected. I knew it wasn't going to be, oh, there's something happening, and I spoiled everything, but somebody will probably beat me to it before even the audio cuts in anyhow, so we'll see. Yeah, I got distracted by that myself. What was I saying? Oh, it is kind of interesting, at least, to think of whether or not the designers or developers, with this 17-card change, how it might have impacted things, and whether it did. I'd be interested to hear from Dan at some point on that. All right, so Army wins. I think he wins. We didn't do one last week, right?
Nobody. Correct. No one won last week.
Okay, and the week before that, did anybody win?
I don't have them written down.
Okay. I don't think anybody's won, so I think Armies actually gets three packs here. So I'm going to send Armies three packs, and I spoiled the siren. I couldn't help myself. It was just a gut instinct to mention it, but still, you know, people were paying attention. It seemed like maybe everybody was not on their trigger finger with the siren being so ready this week, because it's been so long since we've heard a siren on the General's tent. And for everybody out there... Oh,
you are totally forgetting that we have at least a 30 second to 1 minute delay on chat.
Yeah.
Armies is like, boom, siren.
Okay, okay. Yeah.
It was just like... Right, I watched it and I'm like, yeah, Armies knows what's going on.
Yeah, I like that siren giveaway. Anytime it happens and somebody is paying attention, it makes me happy, because I think it's just a fun giveaway, and I like that it has become a thing. So congrats to Armies. That's pretty cool. Okay, so we got that all gone. I'm not sure recent drafting experience is a good example of anything. There's a lot of new players that have been making things weird. I shouldn't ever be able to draft 5 Blade Dancers when I'm drafting Mill, but you've done it recently. Another part on that same note is how would I put this? Like, there's, because the set has been out so long, a lot of people are just rare drafting or kind of like goofing around in there and maybe not taking it as seriously. I know I, for one, entered a draft just last night, and here, I'll even show you what happened. Here's the mail to show you the awesome cards I got, because it's the... Oh, that's not the one. That one I actually did decently. This is the one I got my awesome cards, because I came back like 2 hours after the draft started and realized, oh, I was in a draft. What did I get? I got a Harvest of Sorrow. I got a Warlock of Vader. I got 2 Twisted Taunters. Pretty nice, pretty nice. Money cards right there. I got a Shard Ward. Yeah, so that was quite the deck that the computer drafted for me. I wonder what card I had the most of here. I had 2 Karabar Healers, 2 Star Touch Braves. Let's see. 2 Sword Plays. Did I have 3 of anything? I had 3 Scrapyard Dynamos. Okay, okay. And 2 Twisted Taunters. That's my most frequently picked uncommon. Or maybe it's... Because there's definitely some correlation between cards that other people aren't picking and cards that the AI... like. It's going to favor the cards that are like less oftenly picked, obviously, here, since mm-hmm. the AI is doing its thing. But yeah, we got 3 Scrapyard Dynamos. No rares, no legendaries. The AI didn't feel like, throwing me a bone for missing that draft that I realized I had entered and then came back later. So oops on that one. First time I've done that, at least in a month or so, but I've done that a few times. Yeah. I've also entered drafts where, going into round one, everybody got a buy. And I also had a draft not too long ago where I played 2 turns
mm-hmm.
between all the games of the entire draft. There were only 2 of my turns that, like, I ended, and I won the draft all the way. So that was interesting that happened. I think the first one I got a buy. The second one, my opponent didn't show up, and the third one, my opponent left as soon as the final started, so we played the first 2 turns and then they just left. But yeah, you know, sometimes these happen.
Yeah.
I guess it's a case of must be nice. But yeah, I think I might have even gotten a primal that time, to be honest. But yeah.
Well, you know, it's one of those things of there's a ton of folks that are focused on PB, so I definitely understand some of that. You know, the thought that comes to my mind in a lot of cases, when it comes to seeing the stuff in draft is, you know, when the format's been going there for a while, we're all focused on, or we're primarily focused on a lot of other things. And your reason for being in the if your reason for being in the draft is because you need to go ahead and get your alternate art crush,
mm-hmm.
it doesn't matter if you win or lose. Yeah. And so you're going to get unusual drafting behavior.
Yeah, sure. All right, so what do we still have to give away? We still have the Cracker Pack, right? And we still have a draft code at the end. And I think we'll probably just do those because I've given away a bunch of stuff with the other, like the bonus giveaways we basically did. So I think we'll just keep it at those today. But I
sounds
think it's
like
time we do that Cracker Pack. So let's bring this back up and we're going to raffle this off. So here we go. This is for the Cracker Pack. Thank you everybody who's entered so far doing their thing there. And yeah, good times. All right, so what do we got? Nexus C, you are the winner of the Crack Pack. Whatever we open here, you're going to get the rare or legendary out of it. And
I hope we get a legendary.
Yeah, that Boris Vine Lash deck is good stuff. Also, there was something else going on there that I saw somebody do that was really cute along those lines. Oh, it was Pride's Fall plus Mesa Lookout. That one's pretty real, too. Granted, like, the card value isn't as high there. You're just getting, like, a 2-2 troop. And killing one of their dudes for two cards and quite a few resources. But it is cool when people do it, because that's pretty nasty. All right, so we're waiting for Nexus C to respond, then we'll open up the pack. We need his IGN. Yeah, we got good things. You guys rock, to be honest, is I guess what he's going on. All the giveaways and inside of the game, very cool. Well, we appreciate hearing that, doing our show here. We enjoy doing it, and so much love both ways. We're going to give Nexus
and terrible Mokog white boy dancing. Do, 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 do.
Yeah. An Evasion Rumbler or like the effigy with the ruby gem. That's perfectly acceptable as well. You can get them good.
We're going to normal drafting will resume as soon as set 4 hits.
Yeah. And Corey is, I think, one of the first to admit that, like, now that the first iteration of PvE has come out, speaking of which, I mean, they have more PvE already being prepared, which I think is a big deal. We have the Ranger coming out, level cap being raised, and I can't wait to see that. It kind of sounded like it was closer to being ready than people expected, too, so that's a great thing. But the next thing that's going to be coming out as far as major content is set 4. And and Corey has been saying, yeah, you know, they got to get on the 3 sets a year plan because it's been quite a long time since we've seen a new set. We've been playing with this one for a while now, and it'd be nice to have some fresh cards added to the mix. I'm looking forward to it. Nexus is not
all the
around.
Crazy stuff.
We're gonna go ahead and redraw here for the crackback. See who wins it. And this is my sweet Baxter. He is the winner, so we're gonna just need a response from him in chat, and then we'll crack that pack, see what we get, and talk about it probably just a little bit. Definitely, we haven't spent nearly as much time talking about these sets as we did. Yes, he's saying he expected it 5 months ago. Womp womp. Yes. Yes, indeed. I'm getting a little hungry here.
Oh, I don't blame you.
Yeah.
I mean, it's definitely one of those where if they can hit the 3 sets a year starting this year, that would be absolutely amazing. We get an early drop a set then if you get, you know, next 3 months, you know, middle of summer would be set 5, and then towards Christmas we got the drop a set 6. That is that would be very real right there.
And my sweet Baxter might have ducked out as well. We have been running this giveaway for a while. We never reset it today. Mm-hmm. Normally we reset it once at some point. Didn't do that today, so that might be part of the problem with people being around earlier and kind of ducking out for a little bit. But we'll still give them another 30 seconds or so, and then we're going to raffle it.
Yeah.
But on that note, so, you know, if they hit that mark, I think that would be, like, I don't expect that mark to be hit this year.
Oh my goodness, I would be drafting almost nonstop
we're saying
on the channel.
Set 4, 5, and 6 come out, so we're saying set 6 comes out by the end of the year.
Set 6 probably by about Christmas.
That would be massive, obviously. That would be a huge, huge accomplishment if they were able to pull that off. I don't think they're at that point yet, But I'm happy for them to disprove me on that. That would make my day, right? I would be really excited if they started hitting the development cycle that they intend to. Because I think there's even room, like, with it being a digital game, players consume it so much faster than if it was just a physical card game. So, like, there's room for there to even be four sets a year and it still be perfectly comfortable. You do, at some point, start getting into the territory of it's hard to keep up financially for players. And you don't want to create that. I don't think that's necessarily healthy for the game. But on the other hand, it's also unhealthy for stuff to get stale. And since it is digital, there's more room for that to be happening. But that's kind of, there's almost an easy equation to say, like, is this or is this not good for us to release this many sets this quickly kind of thing. But three sets here is definitely important. And looking forward to it. So what I was going to get at there that's perhaps interesting. So we haven't heard from Baxter. I'm going to reroll. And Kripiscano, the winner here, with good old John McClane as his icon. So hopefully we'll hear from him. If not, we're going to reset this. Yassi quit Hex for the 12th time today. He's quit Hex 12 times already today. That sounds like something one of my friends used to say in college regarding quitting other things many times a day. We have all that going on. Anyway, so if we're saying the set's coming out everything, it is interesting because then we're going to start considering when will sets rotate out. What, as far as constructed currently goes, what's going to be considered legal and all of that. And I'm really interested to see where that goes. They have a lot of experience as far as like Chark and mainly him, but also with Dan and everybody else running events and doing things from the competitive angle. Basically, everybody on the team has a lot of competitive Hex experience, but, you know, Chark has a lot of it. And maybe there's other guys on the team that have just as much as he does. So I don't want to speak to saying that they don't. But
of course,
I'm really interested Kripiscano to know what they have planned there. And Kripiscano is here, so I'm going to need to know what your IGN is, Kripiscano, and we'll go back to the pack opening screen and open that up for you and see what you get. And hopefully it'll be not a Chark. It'll be something better than Chark for you. But we will find out soon enough. So we got that going on. All right, and when are we going to see the next stories for gold? Yeah, get that gold thing. I wouldn't be too surprised if it was quite a long time until we did, but those were pretty sexy for sure. That's a good question to ask him. Satolution, maybe that can be one of your missions on the trip is you can make it happen. You've earned the right to request a feature by making it out there, and you say, we want to see those AAs happen again. All right, so Kripiscano gave us his IGN, getting that going on. We're going to crack this open. He says he wants to see a Sun Soul. All right, well, let's see if we can make that happen. I'll try. No promises here. What is it? Oh. It's glowing blue, so no Sun Soul.
You know, speaking of Sun Soul, I got past, in my most recent draft, I ended up getting past a pack one, pick two Sun Soul Phoenix.
Maybe it's because I was AFK and the AI was picking for me.
You were not in that draft. I looked for you just in case.
I definitely wonder. I would kind of, like, I don't know if I want to know, but I definitely wonder what I passed. Data Dragon can dagger me and let me know.
He might be able to find out for you, but sometimes it's just...
It's better not to know.
It's like those times you never really want to know when you missed Uranus, if you've ever missed Uranus. Yep.
Yeah, that's definitely true. All right, so we got a Duplicitous Duke. Not alternate art, just the regular old one. But he's pretty cool, and he's a fun one for PvE, so hopefully you are happy with the Duke, even though he's not a Sun Soul. It's still a Ruby card, you know, and it... Sun Soul, sometimes it costs 4 resources, so they're kind of the same, right? They both have 2 defense, right? So you know, it's kind of like a Sun Soul, but it's not
kind of like a Sun Soul. But
your delivery on that was perfect. yeah, good times.
Oh, that Duke trickster is always womp womp. Yeah. I would probably go ahead and pick the Duke here.
Yeah, Duke is fun. It's cool.
He's a fun card. He combos well.
Combo with the Bombsmith, combo with Prophecy Dudes, combo with. There's just a lot of options in basically almost every shard variation you could ask for. But there's some cool stuff. You can
I
combo
do
them
have
with
to
a big
say.
swinger. You can revert them and then really start doing some shenanigans.
Yeah, I mean,
But
'cause you can with how many uncommons you can pull together, it's not super uncommon that you can't go five shard Duke Bonewalker. Just saying. That's
And on that note, something important. Most veteran players, I haven't even looked at chat. Somebody might have already even pointed it out. Pro tips right here for people who might not know. It creates a copy, meaning that it's going to maintain any buffs or debuffs that whatever this has been shifted onto, or the Duke himself. So if you play a Stirring Oration on the Duke to turn him into a 7/7, and then it creates the copy, that copy is also going to be a 7/7, bashing in for a whole boatload of damage, and you're going to be taking that train all the way to winning town. So yeah, congrats to you for doing that, because that's obviously pretty good to do. But there's all kinds of other variations you might be doing on that, whether you prophesied something that has an interesting prophecy thing that's not just +1/+1. Maybe it's like when it enters play, it does something powerful. Well, now you're going to be getting that pretty often off of this super sweet copy ability. But Duke is fun. What else is in here? Chimera God Fallen, another pretty decent pick for me. Although I don't know, he like the power, the his potential to wombo somebody is very high, but his potential to just get removed and not do anything is also pretty high. I don't know, they're both factors. Perfigy, also pretty decent and not a bad place to start. And Fiery Indignation, all right. I think it's gone down for me in value a little bit, but I think my if I had like four cards in here, I'm picking Perfigy, Duke, Fallen, or maybe Vampiric Kiss. Life Lyricist, also perfectly fine. So maybe that's another addition. But yeah, I these days, if I was drafting, I would just be like, yeah, we'll just play the Duke and try to do something fun. Because these days, like, I haven't been playing as competitive, and I'm just trying to do fun stuff. I don't know if he's still like the best pick. I think I'd take him over the Fallen, because the Fallen has potential to attach itself to like a 0/7 or whatever it is that you're trying to do and bash in for a whole ton of damage. The Duke has just as much potential to do something really strong in that same sense. But I think really, if we're looking at it, it's Duke or Perfigy for me.
You think it's Duke or Perfigy?
Perfigy
I
is
mean, I
too
still like
slow.
Chimera here as
Perfigy
well,
is
though.
too slow in a lot of situations. That's the biggest thing holding it back. But that those might be my picks here. Yeah. Kiss has been performing really well for me, in the opposite end of the spectrum where Perfigy is too slow. But Kiss doesn't kill stuff like Bashers. It kills a lot of other good things out there. So sometimes Refugee is too slow, but I think that might be my pick here. I don't know. So we got that going. Let's roll and see what happens. We'll get that slaughter gear happening on stream because it seems like my I was close to getting something. Okay, we got Uncommon Stardust. I was close to getting a special PvE card equipment. Okay, that not necessarily as exciting. Not too salty. I saw those gold symbols. I was like, all right, today's gonna be the day for slaughter gear.
Today is the day for the
So we got
slaughter
the
gear.
Scrounger Gauntlets off of the Nazzak Scrounger, and he's pretty rad. So how do you say those guys' names? I say it's Nazzak, but what do you NAZHK? How do you pronounce that, Mokog?
Let's see. Then let's pull it up.
Like, it would probably be like a really throaty, like, huh sound, really.
Nazak.
Yeah, Nazzak is what you're saying. Okay. But yeah,
You do have to kind of
I
at the end
picture
of
like
that, I
a
think.
Klingon pronouncing it or something, perhaps. All right.
It is the Nazak warrior.
Yeah. So we're gonna send this over to Krepaskino, and we'll get things moving on. Do we still have anything next to talk about?
All right, so far we've covered the 100K FAQ, we've covered our Avatar of Cowardice, we've covered the game industry article, we've done the trailer, we talked about Jacob Martin's article, we definitely hit the playmat, we talked about our favorite decks, we've talked a little bit about set four and about 17 cards. We definitely did a good bit with Chat Checkup here, especially when it comes to related to all of our picks. It's been great having JJ and Satolution here
Yeah.
to pick their brains since they're both going to be heading out to the Invitational. I think we are probably up for maybe anything that we want to do for top buys and sells, and then
Okay.
maybe giving away our final draft as well as some shameless plugs.
I think that sounds good. So we're gonna skip card of the week is what we're thinking, right?
Yeah, yeah. I mean, there's some fun stuff. Like, I'd love to have Enter the Dream as being the card of the week because I don't.
I gotta get one and play with one first.
All four.
Yeah, yeah. But yeah, we'll skip card of the week this week. Talk about buys and sells. But you know what? One other thing in there, we got what were we saying? We had you know, Zadolution, JJ in here, like you were saying, and I gotta say, it's nice to see familiar names be making it to. I mean, along with Neo, along with a couple other folks out there, it's nice to see familiar names be making it over to California. yeah. So Kuvan's gonna like that. Yeah, put your Dukes up as the one on there. So I liked it. That was on the fly. I got jokes.
He's got jokes. He's here all day, people.
Yep.
You know, one of the things, we'll turn this into a moralizing lesson. You know, the reason that those names seem kind of familiar is, you know, they happen to be watching a lot of the other streamers talking, engaging with everyone on, you know, best ways to play the game, engaging with their local communities and their play groups. And when it's one of those things that I think is often mischaracterized about TCG players is, you know, there are a lot of stereotypes that come with that. We are actually a very tight-knit, close group of folks, and we share our passion there.
I have a lot to say about stereotypes, especially of TCG players, I think I won't say it during a show where it is all TCG players, one of which I am.
You know, it's very easy to stereotype any subculture that you are not a part of. Hands down, it's extremely easy to do that. And, you know, there's no subculture where it is not done to some extent.
Yeah.
Now, that being said, the one of the things that when you start getting into our culture is we are a very tight-knit group, especially our Hex folks here. And that in and of itself is a really big benefit to being a part. You know, jumping into the stream, seeing what everyone's talking about, getting help with whatever PvE deck, no matter what your skill level is, because... You know, in my mind, even if it's just for entertainment, I am glad that JJ and Zadolution can come in and share their levels of expertise and, you know, their insight. They helped make the show better today because they're in here sharing their time. And, you know, that kind of giving nature is, it is a very Hex thing.
No,
and it is also a very TCG thing.
It's all good. No worries, buddy. But yes, that was bad times. That's not a time in my life we try to remember. Thanks. But no, actually, based on what you were saying, is this isn't about Hex. This is more about like physical card game players. And they like because they are part of a very tight knit community. But I think that tight knit community is big a boon as it is a bane. Like in a lot of cases. They can be very gatekeeperish and push away a lot of people that would otherwise love to play games with them. As somebody who's a huge board game advocate, I think the number one thing that like people who are avid game players, whether it's TCGs or video games or board games, the number one thing that they want more than anything else is more people to play with. And I think a lot of communities... and this is, I think it's even more endemic of TCG communities. A lot of them, a lot of the players within them have a hard time recognizing that they might be driving away the thing that they want most. So that would be my big part there. But hanging out with JJ was definitely good times. and that was a lot of fun at Gen Con. I'm looking forward to Gen Con again this summer. I'm hoping, like, we haven't heard yet because it's a little bit early still to hear, but maybe it's just like, I'm anxious to know. I want to know what's happening at Gen Con. Like, hurry up and just tell me, right? So I want to know what's happening at Gen Con this year. I'm assuming things are still happening, but I'm looking forward to it. Yeah, that's good. That's really good. That was somebody else entirely. Yeah, I was hibernating. I was in a coma, and I don't know what happened to that week. It was the week that didn't happen. But I feel like I was in hibernation the week after. That was sad times. But you know, it is what it is. I think it's something that, you know, reaching out to folks that are new Like, the Hex community, I think, is good in that sense. We've been really good about welcoming new players in, not having a gatekeeper mentality, not, you know, kind of being very elitist. Sure, there's people on the post or on the forums who it's their first post they ever make, and it's really inflammatory. And you kind of scratch your head wondering, is this person real, or are they just kind of trolling? Granted, it's the first, like, it's a common thread. It's just the first post they made, and it's super inflammatory. And I think most people actually handle it pretty well, and even they give them the benefit of the doubt on the forums and everything, which is, you know, I can't always do myself. I don't always give people the benefit of the doubt. Sometimes I'll just say somebody's trolling and ignore them. But
if we think about it for a few moments, you know, a good part of our TCG player evolution probably comes from just our subculture growing up a little bit more. You know, as far as like different waves of culture go, we're relatively new. I mean, there are people who are older than when TCGs, you know, were a thing. You know, they're kind of, you know, they have grandkids at this point, so to speak. And so I think it's now that a lot of us are hitting one or two generations, we're having kids, we're realizing that our passions, you know, when you start taking a look at like video games and newer things enabled by the technology and creativity that comes from our culture start becoming those things, that we realize the follies of our youth, so to speak. And it would not surprise me that if some of that is really coming from our what's the way I want to say that, is if the benefit of those is really just coming from having now one to two generations into it and realizing the power of that.
I don't, like, I think it's just as much young people who are guilty. Well, okay, I kind of see what you're saying, too, is, like, the older crowd versus younger crowd and stuff, too. Mm-hmm. I think there's a lot of things at play, and I think it's more than anything, it's just, like, psychology of people in groups kind of thing. Mm-hmm. And in general, you know, a lot of gamers, it's more of a, they might not be the most outgoing people. And because of that, it, the types of people that it attracts are have some unique traits, maybe is one way to put it. But like, so they might not be as open towards welcoming outsiders, I guess is what I would say. And that's the thing to look out for, because that's kind of a trap to fall into. But going back on here, because there's some interesting stuff that people are talking about here in chat. So Unspecified Healer was saying something interesting about Swiss. I need to scroll up and see who he was specifically talking to. I don't see in here necessarily. I find it intimidating, intriguing, knowing that at any time I play a tournament, there could be major players there. Well, okay, so on that, I'll say a couple things, right? The best way to learn, partway through what I was about to say, I changed what I was going to say. The best way to learn is fail a whole bunch of times. I think that's like a good example. If you're ice skating or if you're skiing, those are like two great ones. You can't learn how to ski unless you fall down a ton of times. Like, that's literally how you learn to ski, is you just keep falling down until you stop falling down. And then you just fall down less often. It's kind of how I think skiing is meant to be learned. You go in and you might make some royal mistakes because maybe you weren't used to using the client, or maybe you're not used to the cards. But the best way to learn those things isn't to, like, read up, I think. Like, this is my personal opinion. But the best way to learn how to draft isn't to go watch streams for 20 hours and then read articles for 20 hours. No, it's just to jump in and start playing. And then, you know, sure, watch streams from time to time and read articles from time to time. But nothing will replace practice and just going out there and trying things and being, and then to take it a step further, looking at the way you're playing and being a little bit introspective and saying, oh, hey, I made an error here. I could have done this better. Or, hey, this didn't work. I'll try not to do it again. I don't know why it didn't work yet, but I'm sure I'll learn that at some point. You know, I think that's a big part of it. But so that was what he was saying. And that's not even what got me interested in it, was because down here somebody was responding to him saying, I'm not sure if it was mentioned, but generally there's an unwritten rule in the Hex community that experienced players stay out of Swift Draft, partly because of the worst rewards if you do well, and partly because it's a good place for new players to learn. I think I've Swift Draft once, and I don't even know why. I think it was because there were more people in the queue and I wanted to fire, or maybe I was just rare drafting and I was only going to play one game or whatever reason. But like, yeah, I pretty much only ever do the normal draft. And I think it's just like, because it's in general, like the EV versus time is a lot higher. You either know you're going to win or you know you're going to lose that much sooner, rather than kind of like playing for lower value. And so I think, like, at least my personal mindset, I don't know if a lot of other competitive players out there do the same. I imagine they do. But, you know, I think Swiss is the better learning spot. And I'm glad that they have different queues out there for different folks, perhaps.
You know, it's one of those things of there is no normal draft. There is only Swiss and constructed.
Yeah.
Competitive draft. Now, the other side of that is, you know, we have a couple really great quotes also from chat. Kropaskino brought one up. The master has failed more times than the beginner has tried.
I like that.
That's a very good nugget of wisdom. Yeah. The other thing about you should not necessarily feel intimidated when you start seeing bigger names in the draft queues. Now, I understand that there is a value proposition consideration there. The idea being is you see someone who you know is obviously a good drafter, you suddenly start seeing your value proposition drop away.
Okay.
That is an understandable side.
I'll put the kibosh on that right away, but I'll let you finish.
But the real benefit to playing with the pros and the like that you see coming in, the ones that you know are very proficient at the game, is when you play with better people, you get better when you play actively. So when you're not just passively clicking through, so you're playing and learning. If you want to get better at a game, you play with people who are better than you, and you keep playing with people who are better than you till you get better than them, and then you go find new people who are better than them.
Yeah.
And then you'll get better progressively as you go through. You'll see new strategies. You'll see cards come to light that you may have not had considered beforehand.
Yeah.
And so, you know, you may lose a value proposition on one particular draft, but the lessons you can learn from that can earn you dividends in the future.
All those are true. The other big part on being worried, perhaps, or maybe not worried, like, you might be excited about seeing known entities in your draft. I'll say against me, if you run into me in draft, just because you run into me doesn't mean I'm in try hard mode. So I'd say, like, not to diminish your success for saying, oh, I beat function, right? Assuming that there's ever anybody who ever said that. But if that is something, I'm not trying to diminish it. But on the other hand, I might have just been goofing off and trying to build a all Paladin of Nagan deck. And and maybe that's why you beat me. Maybe I was, what was I calling it? Kismet drafting. And maybe I was letting her pick the cards and then me try to build a deck. I think now with 17 cards, it would be interesting to let Kismet pick all the cards and see what I can do. Because I think that might be fun these days. Although I'm going to be killing myself watching those rares be passed and losing all kinds of value, right? I think there's a lot of folks out there who are just goofing around just as often as they are in try-hard mode. I wouldn't be too intimidated on that front.
Yeah.
Oh,
definitely. Don't be intimidated by the part that we're there. Just remember that we're people,
and as
and we do crazy shit.
As Paridolia points out, the best way to learn how to use Argus is to accidentally void it. That is definitely
you learned quite a bit from that, don't you?
I have no idea what you're talking about. That must have been somebody else who did that. I don't know what you're talking about. But we got all that going on. I'm just catching up on chat here because it seemed like there was a lot of stuff that touched a nerve. Everybody was agreeing that you gotta play a lot. You gotta Spend time if you want to be good at something.
If he beat me, I wasn't playing proper function of 2016.
No, there's been plenty of times where I was playing proper and Epic failed, and I let myself down. We did all that as well. What else we got? And on this the note of drafting and you don't want to play your first draft because you might lose and drafts aren't free is yeah, but neither is going to the movie. At least going to the movie, if you did really well at watching the movie, you're not gonna be able to go watch another movie for free. I'll say that part, right? There's
Yeah.
no, I mean, you can do really well at sneaking out of the movie theater and maybe you'll get to go watch another one for free. I totally never did that a whole bunch of times. These are things. Let's see. And I'm scrolling down. Yeah, set size and diversity of like the draft format. Set size, like the correlation might be there, but it's not always there. And actually, like a unusually large set doesn't necessarily create a good draft experience. Maybe at some points it's going to create an experience where drafts don't feel same enough, right? There's a sweet spot somewhere in there where with that said, though, I am a huge fan of cube drafting, and I wish we had something like that in Hex. I understand the reasons they might not. It's harder in a digital setting for them to make it something that they can make money off of, but like it's definitely something I would pay to enter in the future, so long as there
Actually,
was still prize and everything, so it's
I
tricky.
would pay to enable a guild to create cubes.
Yeah, absolutely. Like there's
And I would be okay with
yeah,
that.
I would love
Have it
to
be
create
something as a part of the guild system.
I on that note, I would pay to just be able to create my cube that friends would be able to play, or we'd be able to stream and play it together with the audience. Like those would be really fun things to do, and I would really like to see them done at some point. I know they're really reluctant to do it, but I'd like to see them find a way to make it work. Like, so we're going off on a completely another tangent, but this goes to Wild West and these other formats is. If they're gonna create these awesome designs that you couldn't do physically, like, why leave it at that? Let us break it open and play with the whole sandbox and really like make it our game that like we are, that's part of the whole idea of Hex is like it's giving you the gems that you can feel like you're being creative with the cards and your choices and the equipment and all these other things. I think there's room for it, and I think the Hex audience like would embrace these things. They just need to find a way to make money off of it, basically, because like I'd be happy to pay for it. So, yeah.
Well, the you know there's definitely considerations
Yeah.
involved. It's one of those where when it comes to making money in Hex, you know that they're going to make money based on the TCG model. That's what they've decided they're going to do, and as they keep to that dream and vision, that's going to define an awful lot of what we
Yeah.
experience. But different things that are great, wonderful to have, like Technify mentioned, Spectator Mode. That is something that's really awesome
Yeah,
for
that's been a lot
making
of
sure
fun.
that we can develop our esports scene. And then different ways to create community within the client are always good. And that's one of the things that's nice with what Cube is supposed to be, is that Cube is good, enabled someone to get greater value from what they've already purchased and be creative at the same time to create a playable format amongst friends, which is one of the reasons why you won't often see those in sanctioned events. And it gives a replayability for a long set
Yeah.
of different cards and
So
stuff.
I'm scrolling down here, and so Sad Illusion asking what's cube drafting. And in general, it's like anybody who is a big cube builder, feel free to correct me in chat. But in general, it's like you have a bunch of your own cards, right? And you really enjoy drafting, and maybe you're like, hey, I'm gonna make my own set of cards from different sets to draft. And in general, usually cube drafts are like a certain number of cards, as JJ mentioned. We'll say 360 or 540 cards, right? It'll just be some number, usually a pretty decently large number. And a lot of most cubes, it'll just be no card is in the cube more than once. But I've seen some other cubes out there. Maybe we'd have a cube where it's 360 cards, and 60 of the cards in the cube are Briar Legions. You could do things like that.
Briar Legion mirror match. tournament.
And so I've seen cubes like that. I don't think that's the greatest example, but it's a good example of cards that synergize off of each other based on how many you play. There's some fun, interesting outside-the-box things you can do on other ends of cube building. But in general, it's like you're putting your own set together to draft. So the problem for them is they're not necessarily generating more packs to be opened and stuff like that. The entry fees are weird. But if players were able to host their own ones and you had to have an entry fee to be able to enter the cube, I kind of almost see it occupying much the same space that Keep idea has, right? Is you're paying gold to go beat somebody's keep, and if you beat it, you're going to get something back kind of thing. Is maybe, you know, I'm just spitballing here, but for cube drafting, right, there's 100 plat entry fee for all players. There's no packs being used to enter, but the winner gets 3 packs or something, right? And you could choose to, even if we wanted to go sandbox all the way, you could choose to let players use functions cube number 5, and it's a cube I built that maybe it's my Briar Legion cube, right? And it's our one there, and that's the one you really want to play with. And if that one's really popular and a ton of people are playing it, well, maybe function gets a little kickback every time somebody plays it. Like, it encourages players to like engage with the community, engage with each other in other ways. I think there might be some unhealthy like shenanigans that would evolve if there was a kickback necessarily. But I think there's cool things they could do for sure.
And it's one of those things of, you know, Hex can have a really good justification for the idea of a custom draft. And the idea being that it's a really good training scenario for getting folks to understand what are things that you'd want to pick and how things work along those ways. And it's actually would be really good for a team to hone their skill in knowing what to draft and to get those core concepts down. But you also have the creative expressions of cubes where you can do various themed cubes, where you can attempt to tell certain types of stories with your cubes, or you can have super powerful, all the broken things, everything's at Titania's Majesty cube kind of thing. You know, when you have a physical product, the creativity of your players can be astounding. And that would be something very fun to see come to a digital product like Hex. The execution of that is probably harder than any of us have a conception of at this point.
Yeah.
And that's okay.
Yeah.
It's a fun mental exercise to think about.
There's some cool stuff they could do for sure.
Yes.
Without a doubt. So, and on Savolution, one thing he was asking is, like, doesn't the cube builder have an advantage knowing what's in there? They kind of do, but I mean, like, that's not really it's not, like, meant to be, like, super competitive in the sense. Although, I guess if what we were going back to was, like, playing Functions Briar Legion cube, maybe not everybody's up to date on the changes that have been done on that list. And if I was playing, I might have an advantage, sure. But maybe the cube creator doesn't. Well, I don't know. Yeah, there's some weird stuff there. But
And it's also, it's a solution to people wanting to have a draft experience, but not necessarily expending new resources on something they're already highly invested in.
That and, like, also, an interesting part about cube is you could have, like, you could make a cube of the worst hex cards, like, of cards you don't normally get to play with, right? A lot of cubes are, like, the best cards out there, and can you come up with the most insanely powerful deck or something like that, or, you know, can you build your Briar Legion deck or, you know, all these other things out there. It gets interesting when you have the rules. So you get to play with cards you might not normally get to play with, or cards from different sets that might not normally be seen together. There's another part of there. So there's all kinds of fun stuff in there. I enjoy that. But good times. What else we got going on? We were talking about that for a whole lot of time.
We're totally up to shameless plugs and going over on time. It's been great. Yeah. I love it. Everyone, waste more time.
I like that, though. We went off on a nice tangent. And actually, like, I started thinking about things. I mean, this is something I thought about a while back of, like, it would be nice to have cubes because I really like it. And Wild West and, like, these other formats that could happen, I would like to... As the game, I mean, maybe the game isn't popular enough yet. Maybe the player base isn't big enough to support a large number of formats, because it's another mm-hmm. format that you'd be adding, right?
Yeah.
But once it gets there, like, these are things that I think not only should they happen, but I think they almost need to happen. Like, to it become a amazing game where it's fully fleshed out and there's all kinds of features and they keep coming out with stuff that players would have never thought of. Like, mm-hmm. these are the kind of things I'd like to see. That's just
me. Now, you know, we are going off on cubes because it's a very soft subject to jump on. You can get really deep into that because there's a lot of pre-existing theming on there. What I'd really also like to see Hex do is I'd like it to take a look at one of these concepts and then spin it off in something we haven't thought of yet.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Because a game can do amazing when it realizes what we want when we haven't told it what we want yet.
Yeah.
And having the designers get into the thing of which is really hard to do with our community because mm-hmm. we're a whole bunch of thinkers.
Yeah.
And we love to spitball ideas. But when I think additional things in addition to PvE that help generate community and give us that additional bit of value for our digital cards, anything that does that is going to be very easy for our community to rally behind.
This reminds me of something, and I meant to mm-hmm. put on the show notes, and actually I think I meant to put on the show notes last week, but mm-hmm. it's still not too late. We got plenty of time. You know, there's still like almost a whole month left till it happens. And
Okay. Now
that we're talking about it, I'm going to bring it up. I'm going to go find the link real quick. And we are going to plug this because it does go hand in hand with what we're saying. And it's not, you know, in this front, it's something that the community has created. And it's something, if we're asking for it and we want the devs to be doing it, but the community's doing it, then we got to support them too. And Krohn has put in a ton of work repeatedly doing the Rock League. There's the link to the Rock League Season 6, which is starting February 29th. And, that's something I want to see more of. I think we had overlooked it, or I forgot to mention it last week. But Rock League is on the way for newer players, especially. Mm-hmm. There's been a ton of new players coming into Hex. We're just about done with the show today, but, you know, stick with us a couple more minutes. The new players that are new to Hex, this is a great format for them to join. It's really, as far as constructed goes, it is really cheap to get into this format. In fact, mm-hmm. if you're having a hard time, like, even, you know, it might be $1 or $2 to build a highly competitive deck. But even if that's hard, you can very easily find other people out there who are happy to lend you or give you the cards you need to play in that. I like the little restriction of the 4 uncommons that they have going. Having these all the different champions makes things interesting. It is a fun format. I highly recommend people playing it. And these are the kind of things that I, in the future, want to see coming from Hex Official, be officially supported within the client. But in the meantime, as players are creating these formats and hosting leagues and tournaments, I think it's great. And I think the community should embrace and support them. That's my plug. So there's my 2 cents on there. Yeah.
Awesome. Go support it. Yeah. Have fun.
But yeah.
Play games. Have fun. Rock face.
Yeah. And it's cool. And especially formats like those get more and more interesting as we get more and more cards coming in and all that good stuff. Mm-hmm. And you kind of start getting some interesting decks you can build with just your commons or in some of your uncommons. Some nice stuff you can do. I think I've played Saddle Lucian once or twice during one of the Rock Leagues as well. But I've played a bunch of other prominent members of the community and, you know, old-timers. Bunch of folks in there. And it's been fun. And, you know, I think it's a great opportunity for newer players to enter in and play and participate and become part of the community as well. But on that note, we have no more giveaways, right? We have one draft code and that's it, right?
Yep, we have the draft code left.
Sweet. So we will handle that, but before we do, I think it's shameless plugs time, and we'll get that knocked out, and, you know, get some done.
Oh, sounds like a good plan. So hopefully all my links are not super broken. They might be, and if they are, I apologize ahead of time. If you are brand new to the game, thank you for spending your time with us. If this is your first time watching us, thank you for hanging out with us. It is awesome to have new faces in here, and I've seen at least 3 or 4 new faces participating in chat. Y'all are awesome, and we really, really do appreciate y'all being here. But if you are totally brand new to the game, this is the first time you're seeing Hex, You are a trooper for making it to this point in the show.
Yeah.
And as a reward for that, go ahead and head over to www.hexccg.com. The game is just out of beta. It is free to download onto your computer. They start you off with 200 PvP cards and the ability to go into the PvE campaign absolutely free, no gating. It is you, your decks, and your skills running through, getting PvE cards, participating packs, all that good stuff. And if you really love it and you want to get your hands on a little bit of PvP action, it is one of the most cost-effective, fully functional TCG models out there. And we have so many cool stuff to do that. And you start that journey at www.hextcg.com. If you enjoy what Function and I are doing here, you can follow us on Twitter as well as Twitch for when we start doing all of our wonderful streaming stuff. You can find Function at FunctionFails on Twitch as well as Twitter, and you can find me at HexHunterMoCog. You'll find us doing a mix of PvP as well as PvE. Function will be doing all sorts of crazy stuff because you never know what he's going to be up to. Yep.
I have some fun ideas.
You'll generally find me streaming on my channels Mondays, Tuesdays, Thursdays, and sometimes the weekends if you can talk me into it. And we'll be doing predominantly Hex TCG stuff. Thursday evenings we do Dino Island, which is a player-made dungeon-like experience, which has got some cool stuff. And you can check out the panels on my channel towards the bottom for some rules that comes with that. If you have gone through your PvE experience and want to try something that's a little different, you're more than welcome to come on Thursdays and join us as we go through that craziness and listen to me doing very terrible and deranged voices.
I think you have a specialty of doing deranged voices, Mokong.
Yeah, maybe. I do need to work on some of my others.
Yeah.
Almost all of the evil guys on Dino Island are crazy.
Yeah, yeah.
But going through PvE,
they have been hanging out on an island for a while.
They
have been hanging out on an island for a while, so it's only...
Oh my goodness, everything on Dino Island is just...
It's thematic.
Yeah, there's a reason. Yeah. It gets a little Dr. Monroe there sometimes. So it's a fun experience to go through. Everyone who participates walks away with a booster pack, and yeah. It's definitely its own sort of experience. I enjoy having and taking folks through there. You're more than welcome to come join us on Thursdays. wait, what was that noise for people before you do that?
FCC Mokog and voice function. Oh.
Yes, Function has his own now.
Yeah, those would be our, if we had General's Tents emojis, those would be our emojis.
Oh man, I wish we could make emojis.
I would have the Argus shooting the laser, melting me. This is what you get for voiding me, I would be saying. You betrayed me.
So, you're more than welcome to come hang out on the channel. Let's see, are you still doing your Twitter interactions?
We're not really doing What the Hex as much, but I'm still, like, I'm regularly posting stuff on Twitter, and a lot of people have been interacting, even more, lately, just kind of asking question of the day or other things over on Twitter, so it's fun just to participate there. Every once in a while you'll see somebody from, the Hex team respond to a question, or you'll just see a bunch of other people in the community respond to stuff, and it's fun to just start that little discussion, even if it's just something casual or something about, like, you know, actual gameplay or being or you know, pro tips out there. Argus voiding himself.
It'd
be like the when you look at the mirror and it has the picture of the, like, or you look at the TV and it has a picture of you looking at the TV with a picture of you looking at the TV. It's just Argus voiding itself forever. That'd be terrible.
No. Perpetual voiding.
Yeah. I probably will be streaming tomorrow, I think. Mm-hmm. I gotta go out to the suburbs and meet somebody. And then when I come back out, back home, I think I'll have some time to perhaps do some streaming of my own. Or maybe I'll jump in and let the dinos turn me into their food.
Hey, you're more than welcome to come play around on Dino Island.
I can be the avatar of cowardice on Dino Island. And hopefully I won't void myself, but we'll see about that. You know, might do all right. I'll need some tips from the people who have played Dino Island far more than I to tell me what the optimal path is so that I can maybe finally unlock the secrets that no other has been able to do. But yeah, we'll see what we do there. I'll stay in touch with that. But I think we are pretty much good to go. What do you think, my
Yeah,
man? Yeah.
I think we're good for the evening. We
All
got cool
right.
stuff
All right.
running.
Yeah, I think today was a good episode. We started off kind of slow, but I think as we got into the second half, we actually had some more interesting stuff to talk about, and then that kind of developed onward with itself. And yeah, we had a today.
Functioning his minstrels.
Yep. Well, bad times there. All right. We are
Poor
going to
thing.
go ahead and I was just starting to think of even like more shots fired at self jokes, but yeah. So we got that going. We're gonna go ahead and have this raffle here. This is to oh man. This is for a draft code. The winner is just gonna need to respond in chat. We didn't reset the thing today, so it might take a try or two if we draw people that were here earlier and are no longer here. But there's no problem there. Thanks again, guys, for hanging out with us. Currently, it looks like Dinotropia is streaming over on his channel, so I invite you guys to go check out what he's up to and say hey to him. You'll be seeing him here pretty soon, streaming or however they're delivering content from the Invitational itself. He's going to be one of the shoutcasters, which is pretty exciting. But we got that going on over there. Give that guy some love. But in the meantime, we're going to show you guys some love and throw out this draft code. So thanks again for hanging out with us. Hopefully, you enjoyed today's stream. Hang out with me and Mokog and
Heck
blabbering our
yeah.
mouths off about random topics that may or may not
Oh,
actually be
all of the
related to Hives.
randoms.
And us voiding things that were not meant to be voided. We banished them back, those chaos touch from where they became, or where they came, something like that. But Morinfin, you are the winner of the draft code. Hopefully, I won't accidentally void that before I send it to you. It's a show, not a game stream. I like the stream, but there is a surprisingly low amount of actual Hex gameplay. Yeah, today, I try to talk, or I try to play Hex in the background, but usually we're just kind of talking about what's the news. We do our, it's almost more like a podcast done as a webcast, and so we do our thing there. And I usually try to play more Hex than I did today. I think today was one of those days where I was not on my ball there. Before you draw any update on the drawing algorithm, is everything is in wave? Yeah, is it being rigged? It was pretty evenly spread today. Granted, is it picking the same people over? I don't know. I don't make it, so I
I
can't
see.
really speak on
I
that one.
read that as the draw algorithm for Hex.
The what? The,
The
oh,
Slayer.
he read the, oh, I thought he was talking about me raffling stuff off. Yeah, you got the wrong guy in there. I think it's a, hey, quick, before you leave, tell me how to build an atomic bomb. It'll only take a minute. Yeah.
So, if you were talking about the Hex's actual drawing your cards
Yeah.
algorithm, that's because it's truly random. As far as what the function goes, I have no clue how our pick a person function is done.
Yeah.
We
Rigged.
try to make things as random as humanly possible or as technologically possible based on our
Yeah,
understanding of
I
what
think
stuff is.
nice try. I would say data has shown otherwise. And yeah, okay. So I mean, like naturally, this kind of goes with what I was saying earlier. Naturally, I just kind of like I kind of think that's a trolley question. You might be serious about it and asking it from an earnest spot. But there's been no data. So I'll answer it in an earnest way. There's been no data to show that that there's anything wrong with a shuffler. If you've if you've come up with the data and have think there actually is something wrong, and are coming from a rational point that there is something wrong with it, you can definitely provide that data to the people that would need to look at it, and it's entirely possible that there could be something wrong. But nothing, there is nothing to show that, just like there's nothing to show that the sun won't come up tomorrow, or any other thing like that. People are good at seeing
I don't have
patterns.
a direct link to the thread, Caraput, but there is a thread on the forums, and it's referred to as the shuffler. And so, one of the things to remember is that it is a truly random shuffler, which means that our perceptions are going to be different than what the data actually shows out a little bit. Because normally, there's a
There's a lot of confirmation bias and selection bias. Yeah.
Yeah, there's a lot of selection bias and confirmation bias when you're playing in the physical TCGs. There's a lot of things you're doing unknowingly. There's a lot of things that, you know, depending on how you start a deck, how you run through or shuffle a deck, when you're going through all of those that they're creating a semi-random experience. There's still a lot of things that people are doing unknowingly. In a lot of those cases where the hex shuffler ends up being a truly random experience, and what you end up finding is you have to be very, or you have to adjust yourself to the number of shards. And even once you adjust your shards to what the deck is really needing at any point in time, there's still a good chance, there's still a chance that you'll get Drought or Flood on there, because it is truly random in how those draws are doing. There's a lot more emphasis that you're going to have to do on your mulligans to go through. Learning when and how to mulligan in Hex is very, very, very important.
Yeah. What I was going to say, the other part is, from what people say, or somebody told me, and statements like that. This is more about, like, in public. You know, like, you see this a lot in certain people that might be running for a important leadership position currently. A lot of them might be saying, some people say, well, who people? Like, unless you're one of those people, don't say some people say. Say, you know, Mokog says that function is dumb. Well, don't say some people say function dumb. Say Mokog. Like, in that case, I'm like, yeah, I know call Mokog thinks out. I'm dumb. Yeah, call him out. Say who it is that thinks mm-hmm. that. And that way, you know, if they actually are onto something, then it can be proven that, hey, you are onto something. Or if they're not, people can be shown why they might not be. Reading but nice tangent. You kept us on stream for another 10 minutes, and we're at 9 o'clock. It's dinner time. I'm hungry. Yeah. But,
I would love to actually link you the forum where they properly hash it all out. I am not, it is past my degree of math to explain to it properly.
There's been no amount of data that's ever shown that there's anything wrong with the shuffler. And on that same part, you know, we're talking people who've run, on their own, you know, players who've documented like thousands, if not hundreds of thousands of test draws and not been able to produce any kind of, proof that there was anything wrong with the shuffler, and took an honest approach at it. Like Wordle wasted, I say wasted because like it
all dedicated
Wordle,
a lot of time.
You know, Wordle dedicates analysis. A lot of time towards things that you know might not have been productive, and that was one of them. So there was that. I don't know what else to say, but anyways, that's today's show. We're hanging out, we have our moment here at the end. But yeah, so we got more info. I'm going to send you that draft code. I almost got sidetracked and forgot to send it. So we'll get that sent on over. And what else? You got anything planned in the next week at Hex? You said you're doing Dino Island tomorrow night.
Yep, we're doing Dino Island is Thursday nights, and whenever you can talk me into streaming on the weekend. The way I've put it to folks who do Dino Island is, if you can bully me into streaming on the weekend, I'll do Dino Island, and you're more than welcome to try. And I actually mean that because...
Actually, you know what? We forgot one more important thing.
What's that?
I mean, not to... There was something we left out. We talked about Rock League. Ruby Cup is this weekend.
Oh, yeah. Shit, it is?
Yeah, Ruby Cup is literally on Saturday.
So, oh, man. Oh, yeah, because it's on your birthday.
Yeah, yeah. So, well,
oh, yeah. Your birthday's this weekend.
Yeah, my birthday's on Sunday, so I'm going to be hanging out and imbibing... And just having a good time with friends, probably playing some board games, probably play some Spyfall maybe, and just have a good night, or a good time, and doing all that. I think we're going to go out dancing. There's a soul night on Saturday, but that's totally off topic. On topic, Ruby Cup hype, and that's going to be a thing happening this weekend.
FCC JJ Mokog might be,
FCC Mokog comes back, and that's right. You know, they'll have the regular cast of streamers streaming the Ruby Cup from Five Shards guys over there. And, I hope people participate. As far as I know, I think this is regular constructed. I was looking at it the other day, and I actually should look at it again, because I think I actually will be able to play for once, so I should try to play for once, and all that good stuff. But yeah, hopefully you guys will be participating in Ruby Cup, and if even, like... You got nothing to lose, and there's all kinds of awesome prizes, so why wouldn't you be participating? So we got that
and
going
then,
on.
There may also be the weekly tournaments as well.
Yes.
So there's still the weekly the free five shards, the free five shards tournaments, so you can get your constructed on, and then, I mean, all sorts of good stuff in general. So I, side note, I totally made my first Venon, and I haven't really taken it too far yet, but you're right. That spider in the egg is super creepy.
Yep. I told you. I mean, it's not. I wouldn't say like you didn't believe me because you did believe me, but now you know firsthand. Yeah.
I just. Go I on. Concur.
Yeah. It's super creepy. That's it is creepy. Anyways, so we are in good shape there. You guys all have a nice night, and I am gonna get some dinner because I'm hungry. And then I think Milcog and I were going to talk about more general sense stuff when shortly. You guys all have a nice night. Good luck in the Ruby Cup. Good luck in the rest of your events. Good luck to those that, won draft codes or other prizes on the stream today. I'll be sending out the, prizes for our contest we did shortly. Morinfen, you've been sent your draft code, so hopefully that should work just fine for you. And, everybody else, you have a nice night, and, we'll see you around.
Night, everyone.
Yeah. Less fail, more function, and Mokog saying,
keep being awesome.
There you go. Yeah, you almost forgot. You almost let me leave you out there.